10th race of the NASCAR season from Richmond, Virginia. It's a bright, sunny, windy, cool, crisp day here. Feels more like fall than spring. Points leader and pole sitter Jeff Gordon trying for his third straight win. Defending Cup points champion Jimmie Johnson will be chasing as well, along with Dale Earnhardt Jr., whose last win came a year ago on this track. Also looking for his first win of the year, two-time champion Tony Stewart. Tony's hot temper could boil over on this short track where side-by-side racing creates some tense moments. After rain postponed the race last night, we're ready to go. 400 laps and 300 miles today. Let's head trackside for opening ceremonies.
Gentlemen,
this is the first major sporting event held here in the state of Virginia since that tragic shooting on the campus of Virginia Tech. Our thoughts remain with the victims and the families and five drivers in this race from the great state of Virginia. We welcome you inside the Hollywood Hotel trackside at Richmond International Raceway. Thanks for being with us. Jeff Hammond, Chris Myers are anxious, right? Drivers were ready last night.
They're ready to go. A little sparring last night, but now it's time for the championship round. They're ready to go to the distance.
And last night, of course, they did start the race under caution with rain threatening in the area. They went about 12 laps. Jeff Gordon, the pole sitter. Carl Edwards got out in front. Some of the drivers, Scott Riggs in the 10 car, showing you how slick the track was, even though it looked dry at this point. There was a break in the weather, then more rains came, and NASCAR decided to call it, so they start fresh, start new today to make sure that the race is completed. And Jeff Hammond, with this being an impound race, drivers and crews preparing for a night race now during the day, who makes the adjustments?
Believe it or not, Chris, the biggest adjustment is going to be with the driver himself. He's got to come in here, understand the track's green. It's going to wind up getting slick. You still got to take care of your brakes. But right now, the biggest thing is going to be on the shoulders of those drivers.
Chevys have won 8 of 9 races this year, and the Hendrick cars have been very dominant.
They've been very dominant, but you got to realize Jeff Gordon has not finished better than 30th in the last 4 races up here. And today, these guys may have an opportunity to take him down. Guys like Tony Stewart, Kevin Harvick, and Matt Kenseth, I think they'll adapt better than Jeff Gordon will early on.
All right, our guys upstairs will adapt. We have a Mike, a Mac, and Jaws, right?
Okay.
That would be Mike Joy, Larry McReynolds, and Darrell Waltrip. Guys, good to see you again.
Did you stay up all night, yeah, Chris, right, working up that one?
We have writers for
That's
this
exactly
stuff.
Right.
Don't blame David Black for this one.
I don't think he did. I didn't see that in the prompt.
No, I didn't either.
David Black got a mention. What's wrong?
He got two job. Now. All right. All those 12 laps last night, wipe him off the board. Because we never completed a lap under green, this race will have a complete restart. No laps have been counted. Jeff Gordon has not led this race. It's a whole new ball game. Except, Larry, this is an impound race. The teams were not allowed to touch the cars after the drivers got out under the red flag last night.
Yeah, I mean, realistically, they've not been up to speed with the exception of qualifying since the middle of the day Friday, almost 2 days ago. But I think the big factor is the sun up in the sky. We have not had the sun since we've been here, and I think the biggest thing, these drivers will have to be a little patient in the beginning, knowing they're going to be sliding around a little bit. But the one thing we do know is at lap 40, NASCAR will throw a competition caution, so you know you'll get adjustments in. The other thing NASCAR would not let the teams do is fuel the cars this morning. That's another reason at lap 40 they will let them fuel the cars. If we have a caution prior to that, you can do anything but fuel the car, and I think that's to keep from making the race disjointed. Everybody will be on even ground there.
Well, Darrell, you have a car that's set up to race in the nighttime, and now you have to run in the bright sunlight mid-afternoon. How will that be different?
Well, normally I'd be a little bit concerned, but I had a 2-day test here a week or so ago, so I got a lot of nice notes from that. It is an impound race, so I worked on race setup. It was cloudy and overcast, yeah, but I have notes from the other day when it wasn't, so I feel pretty confident. I'm pretty comfortable. I'm ready to go racing. I just got to remember all the things they told me last night that I'd slept all night and I didn't forget the day.
Let's go back down to Chris and Jeff.
All right, anxious to get going. And Jeff, just a few names fans wondering. I mean, Dale Earnhardt Jr., whose last win 35 races ago was here. What kind of chance do you give him today?
I think he's got a great chance. He's won 3 races here, and I think the key thing is we're trying to emphasize is don't panic early on, realizing your crew's going to have an opportunity to work on that car. Just don't get a lap down if you can help it.
Carl Edwards looking for his first win of the year, hoping to see the backflip. He's going to start on the front row along with Jeff Gordon. Last night when they started under the rain, had a sense of humor. Listen in.
Hell, I'm ready. I don't care if we race in the snow, but it's just a little, it's questionable. I don't know, man. I'd say it's dry enough to race on. Windshield's pretty wet. and the crowd's on its feet in amazement at the blistering pace set by these speed demons and fearless racers.
Edwards takes the lead.
Having a
And now, race fans, please welcome Grand Marshal Jim Stewart as he delivers those most famous words in motorsports.
Gentlemen, start your engines!
NASCAR on Fox. Who will it be today? Another Hendrick Motorsports car. Jeff Gordon, Kyle Busch, Jimmie Johnson have had great success with the car of tomorrow. They have been dominant here.
The car of tomorrow becomes the car of today.
They've been really good with this car tomorrow.
The Hendrick team seems to have it figured out here.
They're going to drag race to the finish line. Yes. Kyle Busch in the five.
They touch once, twice, drag race. Jimmie Johnson.
By a fender.
This is great, isn't it?
Jeff Gordon finally gets his first Phoenix win.
Hang on for a ride through Tomorrowland.
Introducing the all-new Chevy Silverado. Best when you buy it. Best when you own it. Best in the long run. This is our best truck ever. The all-new Chevy Silverado.
And now, get 0% APR on any 07 Silverado half-ton, or get $1,500 total cash back on every Silverado. See your local Chevy dealer.
Man, this Nextel walkie-talkie phone is magic. I lost my helmet the other day. Pushed this button, my helmet appeared. Magic.
New spark plugs are in.
See? It's magic. That's not magic. This is magic. No, that's sleight of hand. Get me a bunny. That's magic.
Get more done with the Motorola Blend and vote your favorite driver into the NASCAR Nextel All-Star Challenge. Nextel, only from Sprint.
Happy Mother's Day, Mom.
Wow. Oh, honey, I love it. It's exactly what I wanted.
Huh. I didn't know she'd like it that much. I wonder what else I don't know about her.
There's a lot you might not know about your mom, but know this. She's into electronics. And this week only, buy this Kodak digital camera and digital photo frame for just $229.99. Wow, Mom, at Best Buy.
Previously on The Rookie.
But I think you got the wrong guy here.
No, Mr. Maxwell. You tried to double-cross the wrong people.
Flight 922 on easterly approach.
Angie, I just got a strange call. I think someone's going after the plane. Are there any access roads to the airstrip?
One west and one north.
Divert the delivery, Angie. Do you copy?
Say again.
Divert the plane.
Jason?
To see what happens next, go to CTURookie.com. Powered by Degree Men. More power than you need. One day you'll need it.
Introducing an automotive breakthrough. Zenit. Only at AutoZone. Now AutoZoners have the power to find you the right part faster with diagrams, photos, and instructions. So you'll get the job done right the first time, every time. Zenit. Only at AutoZone.
Yeah, can I get the love handles, double chin, and some blubber?
Please drive around.
When you get greasy fast food, what are you really getting?
Introducing Subway Fresh Fit Meals with new better-for-you sides and drinks. Subway, eat fresh.
NASCAR Nextel Cup Racing on Fox is sponsored by Chevy. The most wins in NASCAR history. An American revolution. By Best Buy. Make this the summer to wow. Only at Best Buy. By Nextel, only from Sprint, helping NASCAR Nextel Cup fans get more done. And by Subway Restaurants. Subway, eat fresh.
A beautiful day to race in Richmond. Heavy rain last night washed the track clean. Gusty winds, but sunny. So a lot of jackets in those grandstands, and they are mostly full for this race, which is sold out. Daryl, how about a word with Richmond's favorite son in this race?
Denny Hamlin, it's a DW. Got a copy?
10-4, got you.
Buddy, I know this is your home track. What would it mean to you to win here today?
Well, I mean, everyone knows how big of a deal this is for me to be just here racing. So, you know, I had a shot last year, and given the same situation here, I may be a little bit more aggressive.
Yeah, you had a good shot at winning this thing last year. You had a great run there at the end. I hope you can pull it off today. Good luck to you, my friend.
Thank you very much.
Yeah, 3 years ago, he was sitting in the grandstands as a fan here.
Now he's got one of the best rides in the sport. Let's go down for late-breaking stories on pit road. Matt?
And Jeff Gordon has the best pit stall on pit road. Pit stall number one for the pole sitter. And Gordon always excels when challenged. He has a number of motivational factors on his plate today. We've got a green racetrack. He hasn't won three in a row in 7 years. He's had four straight struggling races here at Richmond. But they feel like that is going to come to an end today, especially when you look at their COT success. This year, a first, a second, and a third. But Steve Letarte telling his driver, take it conservative until the competition yells. Steve Burns?
Pat, in 2005, an unknown Carl Edwards burst onto the scene and won four times, finishing third in points. And after each win, he'd do a backflip off his race car, made him famous. But it's been 47 races between backflips, and nobody knows that more than his hometown friend and coach driver, Tom Giacchi. Tom hasn't shaved since his last win.
Carl, please, please win.
He starts second, Chris Devoda.
Well, if there's one driver who may have benefited from yesterday's rainout, it's Dale Earnhardt Jr. Twice since he's been running in Nextel Cup, this race has been run on May 5th. He finished 36th and 7th. Twice, it's been run on May 6th. He won both times. Today's race, May 6th. Now to the editor of Speedway Illustrated, Dr. Dick Bergren.
Well, Kyle Busch starts deep in the field this afternoon, but not to worry. This is Richmond, where he won his first ever Busch Series event, and where in four Nextel Cup starts, he has four top fives, and he also has the car he won Bristol in. Watch car number five come from the back to the front, Mike Joy.
Thanks, Dick. We're ready to race 400 laps around this three-quarter-mile racetrack in Richmond.
There you see it, 400 laps, 300 miles, pit road speed, 40 miles per hour, the pit window for fuel. We know we have the competition caution at lap 40, 90 to 100 laps. DW, final short track race of the first half of 2007, beating and banging. Reach up there and pull those belts tight one more time.
There are our onboard views, eight of them today, as they come off turn four and face the start-finish line of Virginia.
Hey, boogity, boogity, boogity! All right, boys, let's go racing!
Falls back into the clutches of Scott Riggs, who comes through on the bottom, entering one to take second place.
Scotty is loose off of two, though, just like we saw him last night. It was wet. I thought that was a problem. Car's a little loose.
And right now, I know we'll get that second groove, but I think with all the rubber being washed off from the rain last night, they're tippy-toeing up there in that second groove right now. Not quite the grip at the bottom.
Might be a problem with Robbie Gordon, Matt.
And up front, Mike, the 48 team. Now, his spotter, Stevie Reeves, like Larry Mack talked about, trying to get his driver down into the bottom lane because they feel like it's going to be slick early on, especially wondering if they're going to have a second group worked in by the time this race is over. It's a good thing they've got him on the bottom. That's where he wants to be early on.
But I tell you what, Mike, Larry, when everybody's fighting for the bottom, I'm going to go to the outside because I can pass a lot of cars. I'm watching Kyle Busch in that five car. He's working that outside and going forward.
We got trouble. Casey Mears goes around, perhaps off the bumper of Johnny Sauter.
Kurt Busch is around also at the bottom of the racetrack, and looks like Reed Sorensen just stopped to keep from running into Kurt.
And I think what happened, Kurt Busch slowed down, and he did not, the person behind him did not.
Well, look at the flames coming outside of that 41.
There he gets it fired and pulls away.
Just in time.
There you go. We'll get her.
All right, let's see what happened to the 25 of Casey Mears.
70 car Sauter on the inside here, looking down in the turn three over here. Looks like he gets in there, pushes up, no grip, hits the left rear of the 25 car Casey Mears, and around he goes.
And that's the one thing that's kind of the downside of running on the outside of someone is these cars just lose grip right in the middle of the corner.
Yeah, Casey, he's another one that was working that outside, trying to move forward here with everybody fighting for the bottom.
Here's Tony Raines' view of this.
Oh, you see what happened, Larry? Sauter got on the brakes.
Stay low. Come on.
And Ward Burton.
Sauter got on the brakes, slid the front tires a little bit, or locked them. Didn't lock them up, but slid them, pushed him up into the side of Casey Mears.
Now, as the caution flew, Robbie Gordon had been coming to pit road with a tire problem. So he lost two laps in the process. He'll get one of them back with the free pass. Dick?
Yeah, you're right, Mike, about the tire problem. It was a right front that went down, but very interesting about that pit stop. Teams are not allowed to add fuel to the car at this point, and the NASCAR official was standing back there just being so very vocal to the gas man, making sure that they didn't commit a violation, and that's NASCAR. They try to prevent these guys from having mistakes and facing penalties, and that happened in Robbie Gordon's pit just moments ago.
Now let's explain this concept of the competition yellow. Often if we have a rain out, a green racetrack, or an issue with tires or some other issue of safety, NASCAR will tell the teams in the drivers' meeting, we will race a certain number of laps, and then we will throw the caution flag as a competition yellow so you can come in, check out those tires, make adjustments, and everyone do that at once. Now today they've told the teams they cannot add fuel until the competition yellow, and this would prevent teams starting way at the back of the grid from making an early stop and thus gaining an advantage.
Yeah, exactly, because what would happen if we got a caution about lap 15 or lap 20, the guys at the back, they would come on the pit road, make adjustments, and get their tires, even though they couldn't fuel the car. Then when we get that caution at lap 40, they dive in just for a splash of fuel and probably go from about 35th maybe to even leading the race.
I think it's more of a tire issue, to you the truth. On a green racetrack, they like to take a look at these tires. If you pull them off at 10, 15 laps, you're not going to know anything. Right. Run them to 40 laps. If you can't put fuel in, you can't, no need to change the tires until you get to that point.
50 cars came to Richmond to try to qualify for the 43 positions. We'll show you the drivers who missed the field and two notables on that list. Ken Schrader had made every Richmond race for the last 22 years, and he goes home ending a consecutive start streak here of 44. And Dale Jarrett, 424 consecutive starts. That's more than 12 years worth of racing. But Jarrett was not quick enough to make the show, so he sits this one out, as well as the other drivers you see on that list.
See a few cars coming to pit road now to make adjustments, to change tires. See Joe Nemechek, we see Kurt Busch and Casey Mears. They were involved in that caution. Elliott Sadler, the 19 car as well. Steve, what's going on?
Well, Larry, Matt, Kurt Busch has to come to pit road. He said he locked up the brakes, and when he did, he slid the tires too much. So they're making a chassis adjustment. They're going to go ahead and put four tires on. Krista.
Steve, Casey Mears also on pit road for a four-tire change. They're already thinking track position. They know that's going to be crucial in this race.
When a spin happens mid-pack on a short track, the ripple effect is felt all the way back through the tail end of the field. Watch what happened to car two, Kurt Busch.
One of you's up high. Easy, easy, easy.
Just about.
Oh, good job, buddy. Good job.
He just went a lap down, too, Mike, working on that car.
Steve, it's not that easy, is it?
No, it's not, Mike. And troubles for the two team on the, they have problems on the left front. Don't know if it was the air gun or not, but he was on pit road, Kurt Busch was, for a long time.
Yeah, he's going to go a lap down, but what he'll be able to do on this restart, he'll be the only car a lap down besides Robbie Gordon, but Robbie Gordon will have to start at the tail end of the field because of getting a free pass. Actually, Kurt should be able to go up there and start right beside Jeff Gordon on the inside.
Now, it looked like they were working on the car. I don't know if he made any contact with that barrier down there when he slid down the racetrack. He may have hurt the splitter, and they were trying to repair that. I'm not sure. Maybe somebody down in the pits there. Maybe Burns or somebody can find out.
Well, looks pretty level in all the braces, though those struts are in place, Steve.
Mike, just down here in the two pits, I can answer DW's question. It was not an adustment to the splitter, Darrell. The front tire changer is working on his air gun.
Okay, buddy. Thank you. I just knew he was there a long time.
Now, restart next time by.
We're seeing Kurt when he got the one to go in that two car. You'll see him trying to get, before they get to turn three, trying to get all the way up to Jeff Gordon, but he's having to go by 42 race cars to get there.
And you got
to
be careful because everybody's cleaning off their tires. You go sailing by and somebody whoops the thing to the left real quick. Don't know you're there. Can make a lot of contact.
And we'll update scoring. Robbie Gordon is back on the lead lap. He's the last car on the lead lap as Jeff Gordon brings them down for the restart. 11 laps complete.
won't be surprising me.
Carl Edwards in the 99 car made an abrupt move to the inside of Scott Riggs in the 10, but there again, Kurt Busch, you see him there in the 2 car, he had the whole field trying to get his lap back.
Well, and he's got fresh tires, so that's somewhat of an advantage. He may be able to take advantage of that.
In any event, Busch is the only car not on the lead lap, so should a caution come out, or even at the competition yellow, he'd get back up onto the lead lap. Busch and Gordon side by side off turn 4. Almost 3 wide in mid-corner as Scott Riggs looked at the bottom.
Well, that's tight right there. Riggs on the knee underneath the Kurt Busch.
Matt.
Gordon and Riggs, two drivers with two different agendas. Now, during that caution, they were passing messages back and forth. Riggs would like
there
to lead
go.
A lap.
Not going to happen here. Jimmie Johnson gets past him as he slid up turn 4.
Yeah, they went in the corner side by side. Riggs got loose, got into him.
And while this is going on, Robbie Gordon, the 7 car, back on pit road with another flat. He has to have something rubbing that right front tire. That's 2 flats in a row.
More likely a sway bar arm or something rubbing that tire and cutting it down.
Dick?
Yeah, that's exactly it, Mike. I'm looking at the tire right now, and you can clearly see significant damage to the car, to the tire on the inside. They just put another right front on, but Robbie Gordon's in deep trouble with something rubbing against the right front tires.
They have got to find out what's cutting that tire. He'll just keep cutting right front tires, and he may not be lucky the next time.
I don't know if they had time or not, or if they thought about it, but they could put a wheel spacer on there, space that wheel out a little bit, and stop that from happening.
Dale Jr. battling Carl Edwards for third place, Steve.
Mike, when the caution came out, Dale Earnhardt Jr. told Tony Urie Jr. it's bouncing a little bit on the left front getting into turn 1. We're a little bit tight in the center. And his early run is a bit of a surprise. Tony Urie Jr. told me before the race it might be ugly early because of running in the daytime versus last night.
No, actually, it looks pretty good right now, Steve.
Yeah, he's using up the back bumper of that 99 car trying to get around him. Carl Edwards is holding Dale Jr. up right now.
And behind them, Kane is coming, so is Hamlin and Truex.
Junebug takes a look to the inside here off turn 4. I believe, and I can't quite clear him. He tried to force him up a little bit and did.
Tell you, a car that's been on the move. I've been watching him these last few laps. Kyle Busch in his 5 car. He started back in 34th position. He's already made his way up 10 or 12 positions, battling the A.J. Allmendinger. That's up there for the 23rd position.
And the reason being was, at early going there, when everybody was fighting for the bottom, I watched him. He was using that outside, and he was going to the front.
Robbie Gordon, black flag, too fast exiting the pits, passed through penalty to add to his woes, 3 laps down. Good race here. Casey Kane, who has not shown the spark of last season thus far, battling Denny Hamlin. They're having a dogfight for 6th.
And he's up there in that second groove, and it looks like a lot like Jeff Gordon. He's getting really good bite off the corner.
I just think these cars are going to run higher and higher because they won't turn. You got to take them up the racetrack, slide them up. How about it, Matt? What do they say?
Well, if you look at Casey Kane, he is on a streak that he would like to break. No top tens in the last 8 races. Hasn't done that since 2005. From their test session here to their race setup, it's completely different. They have struggled at Phoenix and at Richmond with the COT, trying something new, hoping it gets a spark for their COT program here. Right now, it looks like he's doing pretty well.
Sure does.
Jeff Gordon has led every one of 22 laps. Jimmie Johnson, Dale Earnhardt Jr., the top 3 all in Chevys. Carl Edwards in a Ford is 4th. Scott Riggs is 5th in a Dodge. And here are the Toyota top performers, led, as is often the case, by Dave Blaney.
All Toyotas that came here, there were 8 of them, had to qualify on time. Half of them made the show, also including Johnny Benson in the 46 car, right now running in the 35th position.
Hendrick and Chevy's dominance of the Car of Tomorrow races continues, but it's very early here in Richmond. Jimmie Johnson wants the lead. He had two strong runs at his teammate Jeff Gordon. This time in turns 3 and 4, got inside the 24. And there's our first lead change of the day.
Looks like Jimmy's car is really working the bottom good. Jeff's starting to slide up. See that a lot with his 24 car. Larry runs really good for 20 laps or so, then starts to lose a little speed. 48, just the opposite.
And it looks like where the 48 car is much better than the 24 car right now. Jeff Gordon is right through the middle of the corner.
We've had a couple of drivers polish the wall just a bit, beginning with David Stremme. We'll show you the view from our DLP Ultimate Picture Cam. Watch the silver number 40 middle of your screen.
Just get up there and it just slides into the wall. He actually kissed it a couple of times.
And a lap later, Kyle Busch and the 16 of Greg Biffle had a bit of an issue here. Watch the speeds.
Actually, the Biff never got him. He got loose getting in there underneath of Stremme, I think it was, and that's what got the five loose. I don't think the Biff ever really got to him.
Battle for six right here. Scott Riggs in the 10, Denny Hamlin in the 11. Now, we're about six laps away from what will be a competition caution, and I think that's going to be pretty timely because that's going to be about the time that our leaders will catch the back of the field, and that's what's going to be really important for Kurt Busch in that two, to stay in touch with the leader, Jimmie Johnson, because if Jimmie laps other cars, Kurt would not get the free pass.
Larry, these cars are running around here in almost 23 seconds. High 23-second laps. I haven't seen that here in years.
Yeah, they're about a second and three-quarter to 2 seconds off from what they qualified.
That's incredible how much they have already slowed down. The cars just look like they're slow up off the corners.
New second-place car, the number 8, Dale Earnhardt Jr. Again, working the low side on Jeff Gordon. That's how he took the spot away.
Jeff's car is sliding up the hill now, and he's having to really slow it down getting in the corner.
Darrell, this is the first track we've been to with the new car, the car of tomorrow, where you can run side by side all the way around.
Well, there's enough banking here, you know, other than Bristol, where, you know, it's hard to run on the outside. There's no grip. This is the first track we've been to wide enough with enough banking to allow that to happen.
You know, Matt Yoakum talked about Casey Kane in the 9. What's the groove he's running all the way around this racetrack? I mean, he's almost up to a third groove, and he'll even be higher than he's in 1 and 2 right now. He'll even be higher down in turn 3 and 4, but it's like he has found a groove that this car likes right now, and the stopwatch likes it.
See, you and Larry watch 9 car in particular. You made mention ago how the track already slowed down. The cars look so slow. I looked at the right front or left front wheel on that number 9 car. It's red normally. This car right now is already black 40 laps in. We're not running at night, so we can't see the rotors glowing, but brakes are still going to be an issue today. You're stopping these cars to get them turned through the middle of the corner. You're going to wear these brakes out early on if you're not careful.
But Jeff, I'm getting a report that Casey Kane is very loose off. That's probably another reason he's moved that race car up the racetrack.
Yeah, you get a straighter run off the corner. We got a caution here.
And this is our competition yellow. This is the scheduled caution flag for the teams to come in and make adjustments, check tire wear, and for the first time today, be allowed to add fuel.
Some of these guys are saying, that's the longest 40 laps I ever run.
Now, Kurt Busch, the 2 car, the only car
good,
lap
buddy,
down.
You're doing a really good job. You, the 8, the 99 look to be the best there at the end of their run. Good job.
Chad Knaus giving good information to his driver, Jimmie Johnson. Robbie Gordon is now 6 laps down. Kurt Busch will get the free pass. Now, here's what's going to happen. We're going to have 41 cars on pit road at one time, more than likely. So it's going to be very busy in there.
Now, in absence of a yellow flag, how far can we go on fuel here?
We can go 90 to 100 laps, but I think when you look at the stopwatch right now, the way these cars are driving, they're going to want tires well before that.
Yeah, I think the tires are probably the deciding factor on when you're going to stop.
Pit stops will begin with Steve Burns.
Mike, Dale Earnhardt Jr. just said, man, this thing is terrible to drive, and he's up inside the top 5. He said he's a little bit free in, tight in the center, and free off. They've made air pressure adjustments for Dale Earnhardt Jr. Krista.
Denny Hamlin says his speed through the center is good. He's just a little tight there, but he's losing time off the corner where he's getting loose. They're going to pull spring rubber out of the right rear, 4 tires and fuel. Matt Yoakum.
Johnson and Gordon, 1-2 on the scoring boat. Says their cars are loose. Gordon is almost sideways on entry. They're going to try to fix with a chassis and air pressure adjustment. The 48, Johnson, his car extremely loose on exit. Air pressure change for Jimmy. Dick.
Well, Kyle Busch
Bush had to back up in order to get out of his pit stall. Paul Menard parked in front of him, and with the tail end of Menard's car sticking out onto pit road, Bush couldn't get going. He had picked up 10 positions on the racetrack with a car that he defined as tight in the center. The number 6 loose coming off the number 4. That's out of 10. And it's those numbers that Alan Gustafson used to adjust the car.
You grab the bud, I'll grab the trophy.
Here comes the restart with Tony Raines in second, who took just 2 tires on his pit stop. He challenges Jeff Gordon for the lead and may get it in turn 1.
May get in trouble too.
Yeah, Jeff's car is so good on the high side, gets a good bite off the corner, but I'm sure all eyes will be watching to how this 96 car runs on changing just 2 tires after 40 laps.
Denny Hamlin trying Scott Riggs on the inside. That's for 7th.
I don't think it's a bad move right now, Larry. I take a look at that and see how my car does, and then maybe I want to try that again later.
Maybe late in the race.
Or maybe not.
We'll know here shortly.
I think just the fact that he can hang with Jeff Gordon is a pretty good indication. It's not a bad call.
Front 7 are single file. You see Martin Truex on the right of your screen inside of Scott Riggs. Raines continues to have a look on the inside of Gordon. He's right there.
You know, this track was dirt for a long, long time, and the way they're driving these cars today, it looks like it could easily be dirt again. I've never seen cars sliding around as much as these are.
Tony Raines trying to lead his first laps of 2007. You're looking from him back at Jimmie Johnson in 3rd.
You know, I go back to the report on Dale Earnhardt Jr. before this caution that his car is driving terrible. I don't think anyone's car is going to drive good. But what you've got to look at, how do you stack up against your competition? I think that's the important thing.
Hamlin and Kane, this time it's for 6th place. The Chesterfield, Virginia boys coming to the front in that number 11.
I tell you, that Gibbs car is the 11 and 20, Tony Stewart and Denny Hamlin. They have led more laps in these car tomorrow races than anybody, but have yet to been able to drive one to victory circle.
Here's Matt.
Mike, an early indication of just how much the drivers are using brakes here at Richmond after 41 laps. These are the tires that came off Jeff Gordon Chevrolet. This is the left rear tire. Hardly any brake dust. We move to the left front. Take a look at this. That's how much they're using brakes here at Richmond. And that was the biggest concern that crew chief Steve Letarte had coming into today's race. Brakes, wearing them out too quickly, and brake vibrations.
Well, Matt, we've been to 3 other short tracks with the car tomorrow, but I think everyone feared this place as much as anywhere because you drive off in the corner so fast, and then you have to use the brakes to turn these tight corners.
One of the things that really bothers me about what these guys are starting to do, though, is to...
Trouble for Riggs in the 10. He slows dramatically entering turn 3, and they just about all stacked up behind him. Jamie McMurray's in trouble as well.
Did he get tapped over there?
Right front down, Larry.
Oh, he's got a tire down.
And he can't make the entrance to pit road.
Oh, God, they got 3 more coming. 3 more.
Oh, he's going to have a problem with that right front. He's been in the wall, too. The whole right side of that car is all torn up.
And while that was going on, Dale Earnhardt Jr., you see there on the right-hand side of your screen, he gets by Jimmie Johnson in the 48 for the 3rd position.
Not sure what happened to Riggs. Either he got loose or got tapped, but he is back to speed, racing Montoya for 13.
I wouldn't be surprised if we don't get a caution, because Jamie McMurray can't, the car won't turn. Now he's in a box again. He couldn't get the pit road.
Hang on.
Still no yellow.
Well, the tire's going to fly apart.
It's starting to come apart big time now. He wanted to try to turn down, but the car would not turn with the right front gone. Now you can see the tire just completely coming apart. And there's the caution.
Oh, and did he just get tagged?
Yeah, but Reed Sorensen just about ran the back of him. I don't know if he did for sure or not, but he certainly got close.
And there goes the tire. It has left the right front of the car. And we're under caution for the 3rd time today. This all started for McMurray's number 26 Ford coming down the back straightaway. First, watch Scott Riggs in the Valvoline car, right headed toward the camera now on the left.
Look like he
and
just
there's
got
McMurray
in there.
Getting into the wall as that tire goes flat.
Looked like the 10 car just got up too high and couldn't get down into the corner. Really had to slow down, and I don't know if maybe the spotter hollered at McMurray or something and he got in the fence.
Jamie will finally make it to pit road. Right now he is one lap down. And what they'll probably try to do is get that right side tire changed, try to beat the leader who's coming off turn four right now.
Jeff Gordon has led twice for 44 of the 56 laps in Richmond.
NASCAR Nextel Cup Racing on Fox is sponsored by FedEx. Every day is race day. By Ortho Weed Be Gone, Max Plus Crabgrass Control. Kills weeds, not lawns, guaranteed. By E-Train. And by the auto parts experts at AutoZone. Get in the zone, AutoZone.
Chasing the Nextel Cup here at Richmond, where in September will be the final race that determines the 12 drivers who will be in the chase for the Nextel Cup. Now, just prior to the caution for McMurray, we saw Scott Riggs slow dramatically and inexplicably on the back straightaway. Krista, what happened?
Mike, it was an ignition problem. That's why he slid up out of the groove. He had to switch over to ignition B when he tried A again under the caution. Still the problem, so he's going to stick with ignition B. But that is why the car shut off and he slowed up dramatically.
Always got to have a plan B.
That's right. Fall back. Back up.
Well, that two-tire plan of Tony Raines, it's a little early, but so far, so good. He's been able to hang right with Jeff Gordon, despite Gordon getting four tires and Dale Jr. and everyone else up there. But Riggs gained 12 positions on pit road with his two-tire stop.
Yeah, you know, I'm sure that's going to work out good for him for a little while, but I'm not sure how long that'll hold up for him. As these other guys, as his wares, the other guys will start to come around him, I think.
And you saw Larry Carter and that crew still working on Jamie McMurray's car on pit road. Now, during that caution, some cars at the back of the pack, we had 11 of them, most notably Matt Kenseth. They came to pit road even though we only had 10 laps on that run right there. Their hopes would be maybe a 10 or 15 lap run. Another caution, these guys at the front would come in, maybe they'd get that track position.
Green flag to begin lap 63, and Raines again wants the lead.
Yeah, and I tell you what, Carl Edwards got a great restart up on the right side here, passing to the right. He got by Jimmie Johnson. He was alongside of the eight car, but he slid up the hill going into one. He lost all that spot, all those spots he just gained.
Tony Raines with Schreck on the side of his DLP Chevy. He's going to lead his first lap of 2007.
He'll lead it. Now, Gordon's going to fight back. Looks like he's going to try the crossover move going into turn one.
Man,
he smoked the brakes.
He got the brakes locked up, sliding the tires, getting into one.
He wants the lead back at Dale Earnhardt Jr. in the eight car. He's going to try to follow.
Jeff Gordon needs to be careful. Do you know the last four races here, his best finish is 30th? I mean, you're talking about a cat that's dominated his season.
And a lot of it has been mechanical failure, too.
Six DNFs, more than anywhere else we race.
Now, are you a little surprised here that Junior is going with Raines and not with Gordon? See if he crosses under. Not yet.
I think we heard Junior say on his radio he thought the high line was going to be the way to go.
And right behind them, Carl Edwards, Jimmie Johnson in the 48. Denny Hamlin and Truex in the one. Told you this was a great place for side-by-side racing. We've got it everywhere.
Especially on restarts with everybody on pretty fresh tires.
And I tell you what, right there behind Martin Truex Jr. in that one, a guy that's been very good at these car tomorrow races, 66, Jeff Green right there.
Watch the 99 jump on the outsider. Now, that's legal. You can pass to the right. He gets by the 90, the 48, and he jumps all the way up beside a junior, but then he loses that momentum getting into turn one.
Yeah, on a restart, the minute the green flag is displayed, you may pass to the right, even if you have not got to the start-finish line just yet.
That's what they always tell us on a restart, protect the right, and that means watch the guys come around you on the right side.
Tony Raines led a lap or two, and now, Matt, he's faded to fourth.
And Mike, Larry, Matt can tell you, it's all about confidence, and that's what this second-year team has, 22nd in the championship standings. And what he will tell you, Tony Raines, when they unload and if they're not good this year, they can adjust, especially at the COT races, because his crew chief, Brandon Thomas, was a part of the Gibbs R&D program. As they are working through the nuances of this new car of tomorrow, he feels like that's one of their strong points in 2007.
Well, that's a good, they're a Gibbs team, or a satellite team of Gibbs. And you take the 66 and the 70 of Jeff Green and Johnny Sauter. They're satellite teams of the Hendrick group, and all those cars run very well.
Edwards to the inside. He's got Hamlin in tow and Truex.
But I think those two tires will do just what I thought they would do. He's going to pay the price after they run a few laps. Tony Raines in the 96. I just don't think those two tires are going to hold up for it against guys with four tires.
Great race here for fourth place. Raines trying to hold off Edwards, Hamlin, and Truex.
Boy, Carl Edwards in the 99, he drove it down in there. You can see him paying the price a little bit, sliding those front tires, smoking the brakes.
And this group better not dawdle, because right behind them, Kevin Harvick draws a bead on Jeff Green to the inside. That's Harvick in the 29. With Delaney and Sauter.
It's going to be a loud roar here in about another lap or two. And it won't be from the cars.
Before that, let's get Steve in.
Hey, Mike Joy, Kevin Harvick started 27th. He's making a march to the front one here in September. His car is race cars handling well, but he does have a concern. He's reported to the crew that he feels the brakes, his quote was, shaking.
You hear that a lot here, and it's because you're on the brake so long. You got to get on the brake as you go down into turn one, big sweeping corner, and you ride the car down with the brakes. It's almost impossible to stop the car. You got to ride it down, and that creates a lot of heat, warps the rotors. You get that vibration.
Tell you what, a guy that's having a good run as well is that car right there on the bottom, that Toyota number 22, Dave Blaney, had a good qualifying run up there in 10th, had his best finish of last year here in the fall race, 4th. He's still up there battling in the top 10 with that 22 car.
Car looks good on the bottom, too. He's accelerated up along beside the 70 car there.
Yeah, he's the best Toyota in the race by 20 positions.
You know, we talk about how hard it is for a driver to go back and forth from the Busch current car to the car tomorrow, but I see a car back there right behind Tony Stewart, Juan Pablo Montoya, that 42 car. He ran the Busch race. He qualified 42nd for that Busch race, but I think that seat time Friday night paid off for him, finished 11th in that race, and here he's up here in the top 15 at a racetrack he had never made any start at before this weekend.
Montoya and Biffle in the 16, chasing Tony Stewart, who is 12th.
Biffle's car has been looking pretty good. He's able to run the bottom. He's passed quite a few cars, and that car looks pretty decent right now early on. Just see these guys, old Mike. Larry, when you drive in the corner real hard, they just will not turn. They scoot up the hill.
Getting a report that Jamie McMurray, Larry Carter and that group, they had to take the 26 car to the garage area. This could be a big hit for this car that came here 7th in the points, McMurray.
Now he could lose half a dozen positions or more.
That's a shame too, because Jamie's been doing a great job. Larry Carter, car's been running real consistent.
Three-car breakaway, Jeff Gordon, Dale Earnhardt Jr., and Jimmie Johnson. How about that third-place car, Matt?
A problem for Jimmie Johnson before that competition caution of the car when he hit the throttle, which just jumped sideways. Chad Knaus tried to fix that with an air pressure change, but there's a problem developing that he won't be able to fix until after this race is over. Chad told me the brakes are vibrating, but Jimmy hasn't told Chad the severity of the vibration. But right now, that is a strong concern here in the 48 pit.
I think brakes are going to be a determining factor in this race. We've been talking about that all weekend long with this car tomorrow.
They've got the best brakes they've ever had, but with this car, cooling is questionable. And the brake ducts that they are required to run are not adequate for the kind of braking that we have.
So Jamie McMurray in the garage. Here's Krista.
Well, down here with Larry Carter walking back to the garage. Larry, what happened? You guys were on pit road for a while working on that right front.
Yeah, it looks like we broke a shock absorber, so evidently when it broke, it bent the suspension on the car, so we're going to have to go in and get all that stuff fixed and try to get back out and get what we can get.
All right, we'll let Larry go. He's got a lot of work to do, but this is really a rough break for this team. They had tons of momentum coming in here. They gained 5 positions and points last week.
I tell you what did a lot of damage, and it can damage your suspension as well, is that tire flopping around there. Once he cut it down and he had to stay on the racetrack, that'll tear up everything.
Yeah, he had to run a mile and a half before he could get the pit road.
Jeff Gordon has now led 68 laps. He's led for 3 times, and he's out front here at lap 81. You're watching NASCAR on Fox.
I'm sitting in a hot rod today.
Since this track was enlarged to 3/4 of a mile 19 years ago, only 3 races have been won from the pole. Davey Allison, Bill Elliott, and Casey Kane, the drivers to do it. Jeff Gordon's doing a pretty good job of wearing them out in the early going today. He leads Dale Earnhardt Jr. by a full second now.
He's just found the groove of this 24 car. You know, you can see he lets the car wash up the racetrack a little bit, but his car gets such a good bite off the corner. But right now, when I look at our top three, visually and on the stopwatch, Jeff Gordon, Dale Earnhardt Jr., and Jimmie Johnson, the 3 cars are just equal almost lap after lap right now.
Larry, as I watch them come off of turn 2 over there, though, every now and then I look over and I think the caution flag's out there coming off there so slow.
How about the second place car, Steve?
Hey, Mike, DW was right a little while ago. Dale Earnhardt Jr. said he wanted to run the high side. The problem with that is it ruins his exit from the corners. He said he's having a real tough time getting off the corners. So Tony Eury Jr. is telling him maybe just stay on the bottom then.
And there's such, I think what they're, you know, facing here, Steve, Darrell, Mike, is the fact you have to do so much to get the car to turn through the middle is you kill your forward bite or the rear wheels hooking up off the corner. If you tighten it up to where you get off the corner, the car will not turn through the middle.
Both of Junior's teammates are in the race, Paul Menard in 35th and Martin Truex in 8th place. Here's Truex, here's Matt.
Rebounding from last year, Mike, when he finished 41st and 40th, his worst finishes at Nextel Cup competition. Martin says the cars here at Richmond just so finicky. He described his technique for getting around this place as basically stopping as soon as you get in the corner, turning, and then gassing it again. The car, he says, is hopping in the front. It's still tight, but he is running solid right now in the 8th position.
See, that's the difference in this car and the car that the current car. You have got to wait on this race car, and these guys are not used to that. The current car, you drive in as hard as you can, cut the wheel, mat the throttle. These things, you drive in, wait, and then ease in the throttle.
Well, you know, guys, we sat down with Jeff Gordon last week, and he was not a big fan of the car tomorrow. But when you look at the success he's had at places like Road Courses, Martinsville, where you finesse the race car, I think it's fallen right into his lap the way you have to finesse this car tomorrow.
A whole new ball game now, Larry, because the leader has caught traffic. He's got past Kenny Wallace in the 78, now pulls up on Allmendinger in the 84, but things are about to get busy for the leaders here. We've talked a lot about the brakes on these cars. Let's show you some. Jeff Hammond.
Mike, we're down here at the Ford Cutaway car, and what I want to talk about, what Darrell was talking about, pulling these brakes. If you take a look. Look right in here. You can see where the brake ducts are located, kind of stuck back in this nose area. But the key thing may be the duct itself. This is what the car and bar brake duct looks like. It's back in there. Compare it to last year. This, it looks to me like much wider, much more of a megaphone to suck air into. As a matter of fact, you can just about take this duct and stick it inside of the other one. Again, trying to flow air to these brakes is so critical when it comes to short track racing.
And what cools the brakes is the velocity of the air. So when it goes in that big opening in that the current car has, then it forces itself into those small holes and blows hard into the brake. This car tomorrow, it's got the great big openings and it doesn't get the volume of air.
And I think we understand the airflow on the nose of the current car. There's no question. But when we've been to the wind tunnel, we've used smoke tests, it's like that splitter in that cavity, the air's confused. It's not sure exactly what direction it's going to go. Talked about Jeff Green a while ago in that 66 car. He's battling Carl Edwards right now in the 99 for sixth. This is another operation. They've been so good. Haas Racing with Jeff Green in 66. Had that great run at Bristol, a good run at Phoenix. You can see he gave Carl a little tip of the hand. Thank you for not pushing the envelope here. We still have 300 laps to go. I'm faster than you right now.
Jeff Green up there, he's running in
Sixth position.
His teammate, Johnny Sauter, they're running in a top 10, just like they've done every car tomorrow race we've had.
But as you mentioned earlier, Darrell, they're a satellite Hendrick team, and I think if anybody's dotted their I's, crossed their T's with the car tomorrow, besides Joe Gibbs Racing, Hendrick Motorsports.
Steve?
Mike, just heard Johnny Sauter say, this car is real loose. I'm just doing the best I can. Hey, after the Phoenix race, Johnny Sauter told Larry Mack and I like this car tomorrow. I think it's the way to go.
Well, you would like it. They had great success with it, and they're getting good finishes with it.
But here I go again. I think this is where Booty Barker
trouble,
is.
Trouble, front straight away. Elliott Sadler.
Right front, down.
And you know, another reason, I think there's several reasons we're losing right front tires, but another reason could be these brakes are getting so hot, you can cook the bead of that tire, and just the tire goes down. There's several reasons I think these right fronts are going down.
I think you're right, Larry. And the tires, they got the right front leaned in so far, so much camber in the tire, that it's easy to
beat up.
You
got a right front now, looks like.
Yeah, I got a right front flat.
Yep. You do?
He
confirmed all the way around.
Wasn't very excited about it either.
All right, watch the top of your screen. We'll see how this gets started. Look for the white and red number 19 Dodge. Here he comes.
Just right there. He's fortunate that the thing just starts to turn around with him because normally that right front goes down going in the corner and you don't drive it back to the pits.
Pit road is closed, but of course Elliott Sadler, the 19, did make it around to the attention of Josh Brown in that group, and there you can see the right front tire coming off. They'll get their right side tires changed. They're going to go ahead and do four tires because he's already lost a lap. Might as well go and get them both, all four.
Yeah, this is what McMurray wishes he could have done.
Right, but he couldn't get to pit road. A.J. Allmendinger was the first car one lap down, so his Red Bull Camry will get the free pass and be back on the lead lap.
Well, Steve, it's been about 50, 60 laps. I'd say pit road's going to be a busy place. Here they come.
Dale Earnhardt Jr.'s complaining about being tight in the center. They just can't fix it for him at this point in the race. They're going to make a track bar adjustment for Dale Earnhardt Jr. Krista.
Denny Hamlin also saying his car is tight in the center. He needs forward bite. They're going to try to get it with an air pressure and a slight track bar adjustment. Matt.
Early in the race, Krista, Jeff Gordon said his car was just so sideways. Looked like he was on the dirt at Eldora in Ohio. They fixed that. It's not as bad on entry into turn three, but still, they need help in turn one. Going to make an air pressure adjustment. The same thing for the 48 of Jimmie Johnson, also pulling a spring rubber. Dick?
Well, Jeff Burton has come and gone. He is having a good day. Started in the 39th position. He has picked up 21 spots on the racetrack. His crew, they are the walking wounded. Four of the seven over-the-wall guys aren't on duty today.
Wow. Say a big hello to all the folks watching at Lowe's Motor Speedway today, where they've just completed the Ricky Hendrick Memorial Charity Ride. Getting ready for the restart. Dale Jr. back in ninth. They lost seven positions on pit road. Green flag.
Tell you who had some good pit stops, though. Denny Hamlin at 11, sitting up there in second right now. Kevin Harvick in the 29. That group moves him up to third. Great pit stops.
I think old Denny Hamlin would like to get up there and lead this race if he possibly can. You know why? Because probably about two-thirds of these people have seen this kid grow up, and it's exciting to see him out here racing today.
Well, like you said, Darrell, they've been coming to race here on Strawberry Hill since this was a half-mile dirt track, and a lot of great drivers from the state of Virginia and from the Richmond area have dominated here on many an occasion. Wouldn't it be nice for the hometowners to see Hamlin have his turn in the sun?
I know he wants it, but I tell you, another guy that wants it too, and he's looking pretty good, Larry, and that's that 29 car that's closing down on his back bumper right now. That car of Kevin Harvick's is looking pretty racy, too.
You know, we watched him there before that caution. He found him a groove up in the high line. Now, he's not quite up there now on fresh tires, but as we got into that last run, he entered high, stayed high, and came off the corner high with the 29.
Looks like if you can drive her in pretty hard, use a lot of brake, get her woed up, and then if you can cut it and stay in the throttle up off the corner, that's a good handling car.
Hamlin looking back at Harvick.
That's a good handling car tomorrow, I should say, because that's what these guys are trying to figure out with these cars, how to drive them.
Greg Biffle's gained 26 positions, Harvick 24, and his teammate Jeff Burton 22. Biffle wants another one. He wants his teammate Carl Edwards for fifth.
NASCAR Nextel Cup Racing on Fox is sponsored by the new Ford Super Duty, built to work harder for you. By Wendy's, get in the middle of flavor, check out Wendy's new Double Melt, and do what tastes right. By Fram, it's not just an oil change, it's a Fram oil change. And by Allstate, official insurance sponsor of NASCAR. Fox, glad to have you with us. Jeff Hammond, Chris Myers, and more than a quarter of the way through this race in Richmond, Jeff Gordon has led all but 13 laps. The pole sitter going for his third straight win. Kevin Harvick, who was one of two drivers, Jeff Hammond, who finished in the top five in both of these races last year, has worked his way up to third.
Yeah, he looks really strong right now. He started way back in the back right there, but this car is going in and making the turn. He's able to get back in the throttle and drive it up off the corner, and that's really where the big difference is as far as that 29 car is concerned and everybody else.
Moments ago, Darrell Waltrip talking about Greg Biffle, who's up to fifth. The current leads had a rough start over the first nine races this season.
Oh, he has done that, sure, but that number 16 car looks like it used to several races or several years ago when he was on a tear, just winning a lot of different races. He's got it working better today.
Now, Dale Earnhardt Jr., as Mike Joy pointed out, lost all that ground on the pit stop, but working his way back up to seventh. What kind of car does he have today from what you can see?
He's got one that can be competitive right here toward the end. If the crew just doesn't keep hurting him, he can't keep working his way up through there using that much of the race car and the brakes to get to the front for them to put into the back.
We've had 4 leaders, 5 lead changes, 4 cautions so far, and Chevy's Mike Joy have the top 4 spots in this race.
Thanks, Chris. Followed by the trouble turn 2. Montoya hard in the wall with Sauter.
These guys had been going at it hard. Kyle Busch in the 5, he had been in this group right here. They've been going at it for about 3 or 4 laps. A lot of damage to the left rear of that 70 car. He's had a pretty good car all day long. You see also damage to Montoya in that 42 as well.
Yeah, it's a shame. A 70 car had been running a top 10. He and his teammate Jeff Green both. So that's an unfortunate thing to happen right there.
They were racing for 12th place. That's where the 5 was of Kyle Busch. Just ahead of them and squeeze play here.
You know, I'm not so sure that he didn't make a little contact with Ryan Newman, the 42 car of Montoya, and that sent him into the 70 car of Sauter.
Now, those two have a history, Montoya and Newman, but the last dust up between the two of them was not a driver incident.
Yeah, you can see right there, he gets into Johnny. Johnny was just, the 70 was just a victim, but you're right, Mike, they got together at Talladega. I talked to Montoya. He said, look, we didn't get together. My steering broke. And it made it look like, yeah, they were just at it again.
Let's watch from Jeff Burton.
Let's see right here if, yeah, I'm thinking that the 12 may have just touched the 42.
Stay down. Good job, buddy. Good job. Caution that away.
Tony Stewart had been running 14th when he came to pit road. Montoya's crew on damage control. Matt?
And Stewart's on pit road. He, like so many of the guys, just saying he needs help on exit of the corner. They were talking about pulling a spring rubber out of the right rear as work continues on the left side. Now Todd Foster gets a lug nuts on and Stewart's away. Krista?
Juan Pablo Montoya obviously had to bring his 42 Dodge in because of that contact. They were trying to cut some of the rear bumper off as well as put the four tires on. Before that, Montoya said his car was really, really tight. Now he's got a whole nother issue, guys.
Yeah, a couple things. What they were doing on Tony Stewart's car, they're dropping the track bar on the left side, trying to tighten him up.
You know, one thing I'm happy, there's been a lot of concern about this rear wing on this car. The 70 and the 42 actually got into the wall pretty hard. Looked like those two rear wings on the back of those cars did not even move.
You can definitely see, well, if you go back far enough, that the 12 did clip the 42. Right about there.
So this is the fifth caution of the day for Johnny Sauter and Juan Pablo Montoya.
Track bar. A little bit more track bar.
A little bit more track bar. You got that?
While we're under caution, here's Jeff Hammond with today's State Farm Safety Report.
When it comes to short track racing, we all know how important it is to keep the brakes cool. NASCAR allows three hoses to cool the brake caliper themselves. But at Richmond, they're allowing them to run a bead blower. That means a separate hose with a fan that can blow air right in this area between the rim as well as the tire. What they're trying to do is protect the bead of the tire. This is where the bead is located. You'll see the wire mounted inside this rubber, which also seals off to the rim. If it gets too hot, it will melt, the tire will fail. Driver will knock the wall down. Bead blower hoses could be the most important thing here at Richmond.
Yes. And I definitely think that we've already had some tires that maybe had that cooked bead. Now, what that is, that's like a drill that's hung in the back of the 70 car, a cordless drill. Johnny Sauter and Juan Pablo Montoya both still trying to stay on the lead lap, and they are, but he's got a Sawzall actually still stuck in there. They're trying to cut that bumper bar off. It's hanging on now. I think it may make the whole trip back to pit road. I've seen a lot of things drug away from pit road. I'm not sure a Sawzall is one of them.
I don't think that's part of the durability test.
Now they're going to hold him a lap because he did run the stop and go paddle at the end of pit road. That time he's got more problems because we're going back racing. He's sitting on pit road.
Chesterfield, Virginia's Denny Hamlin in the number 11 wants the lead from Jeff Gordon.
It's going to take quite a bit to get it away from you. I can tell you that 24 car has been pretty hooked up here. See if Jeff will give him some room getting into three. Denny's got that bottom line working pretty good right now. He's going to push out. I think he didn't quite make it.
By 1/100th of a second, Gordon held the lead that lap. But Hamlin keeps coming.
Boy, I tell you, this is tough sledding right here for both these guys. That car on the inside gets a little bit loose, slides up the hill. That could be disastrous.
But while they're doing this, here comes Kevin Harvick in that 29 car. He's going to make it a three-car battle. He'll go to the inside going into one.
Better think twice about that. It's okay to look.
And stalking that group is Greg Biffle. Here comes his number 16 Ford.
I tell you, the Biffle's got a pretty good car today, guys. He's looking awfully racy, and so is the 29.
You know, you talked about how many laps Joe Gibbs Racing has led. A Ford has only led one lap of the car tomorrow races.
Here we go.
They get Gordon up the racetrack. Hamlin to take the lead back, and here comes Kevin Harvick. He's trying to get up there and lead a lap.
Jeff just drove in a little bit too hard, slid up the hill, and opened the door for Hamlin to go by on the inside and brought Kevin Harvick right along with him. Kevin's car is awesome right now.
Now, Dale Earnhardt Jr. still fighting his way back from a bad pit stop. He gets got by Greg Biffle in the 16 for the fourth spot.
What's his 29? I think he'll drive right around the 11. Of those cars that are racing there in the front right now, the 29 is just a little bit better. So you can get that run on the outside. Hamlin's got to give him the room. He's got the momentum coming off the two. I think he'll drive right on by.
This is where Harvick has been so strong up in that second groove. His car gets a good bite. He will lead this lap of the 29 car and take the lead of the race.
Adios.
Meanwhile, Tony Stewart had that long stop under caution, came out at the tail end of the field, and Matt, he's not making a whole lot of forward progress.
Mike, the three-time winner made two stops on pit road. Zippy, what were all the changes you made to the 20 car?
Now, we were just really loose off. We expected a race last night with a lot cooler track then, so took us a bunch of time, but we got the rear bar off of it and made some other changes. Hopefully, we'll get the Home Depot back, Chevrolet up front here before long.
Unhook the rear sway bar, also pull the spring rubber, track bar adjustments, you name it. He's at the back, and remember, Street Sense won the Kentucky Derby from next to last. That's just about where Stewart's running right now. He's all the way back at 34.
Those are some of those adjustments that you have built into your car, though. Unhook that rear sway bar, that tightens the car up, pull the spring rubber out, and they drop the track bar on the left side. That's a lot of changes in one stop.
But I think that goes back to what we talked about before the race. Track conditions just much different. They probably had that information from that test you talked about.
And Stewart and his crew have the confidence that they can get those positions back.
Tell you, that 16 car, Larry Biffle, he can run the bottom and get up off the corner about as well as anybody right now.
You saw him acknowledge Dale Earnhardt Jr. You know, again, I was faster than you. Thank you for letting me by, not holding me up right now.
Watch this thread the needle with Kyle Busch. He's going to try to split Sadler and Truex. Now gets a little position on Elliott's number 19 and couldn't bring the car down to make the pass on Truex.
I've been keeping one eye on this five car since the start of the race, and Dick Bergeron started back in 34th. He has now made his way up into the top 10, headed to the top five.
Yeah, not bad for a guy that says he doesn't like the car of tomorrow and doesn't really much enjoy driving the car of tomorrow. Alan Gustafson told me before the drop of the green flag today, Larry, that they weren't at all worried about the change in weather because this car was tested in weather just like this, and it was a rocket ship. Gustafson predicted this, that the car would go from the back to the front, and he was right.
Only two drivers have top 10 finishes in all three Car of Tomorrow races, Jeff Gordon and Kyle Busch.
These cars are hard to drive. There's no question about that. That's why guys don't like them.
And you can't overdrive them either, and trust me, Kyle Busch drives a car about as hard as anybody out there on that racetrack.
Good old-fashioned horsepower.
Stock Cup Racing on Fox is sponsored by DirecTV. Just say ride shotgun on race day with NASCAR Hot Pass, only on DirecTV. By Lowe's, proud home of Jimmie Johnson and Team 48. By Coca-Cola, thanks for drinking. And by Singular, now the new AT&T.
Getting ready for what could be a lead change here. Kevin Harvick was way up the racetrack. Denny Hamlin got underneath him as Harvick got some rubber buildup on his tires. But Hamlin has not quite been able to snatch the lead away. We are 145 laps into the Jim Stewart 400 presented by Crown Royal. Jeff Gordon has led 114 of those laps, but it's been Harvick out front for the last 15, and he was sailing along until he took that big slide up the track in turn three.
If you drive in just ever too far, just a little bit too far, the car takes off. Seen it a couple of times with other cars.
Guys, I know one car I've been watching. Let's go back 144 laps ago. Kurt Busch in that two car was laying against the inside wall in turn four. He went a lap down after a bad stop. He got a free pass. He just passed his brother. He's back in the top 10 with his two car. He got there before we could even get to him.
He has really raced hard back up to seventh place. The Lennox Sawblade Chevrolet has gone to the garage early. Dick Bergeron is there.
And he had been having a good day. Jeff Burton had moved from the back of the pack to about the middle of the pack, but engine problems earlier this week in practice, did that have anything to do with this engine failure?
No, that didn't have anything to do with it. This car was really fast. Lennox Chevrolet was on old, you know, about 20 laps into a run, this car was really fast. We were marching up through that really nicely. Just, you know, can't win championships like this, and it's really frustrating.
The look on his face when he exited the car, Mike, said it all. I'll tell you what, this is one disappointed race car driver.
Well, he came in here third in the Nextel Cup standings, Dick. And it's a very early exit. There's only one. There are no other cars out of the race now that Jamie McMurray has returned.
I still would like to talk to those guys, because what Dick Berger mentioned on Friday before qualifying, they actually dropped something down in the engine, and they didn't change that engine. They actually had the oil pan off trying to find whatever they dropped down in there. I still, until I talk to someone, I will question that one.
Yeah, what did you and I say? When in doubt,
pull it out.
Pull it out.
That's Dave Blaney ahead of Tony Raines as we ride with the DLP Chevy. Blaney having quite an afternoon. He's in 11th place right now. He and Jeff Green battled. And further to the front, Jimmie Johnson has passed Greg Biffle and retaken fourth place. Matt?
One of Biffle's two top tens this year, Mike, came in a CLT race. That was back at Bristol in March. Right now, the car, he's happy with it. It's still a little loose on exit. They have progressively made changes, and it's made improvements to this race car. This is a run that this team desperately needs as we start to head into the summer months. They need some good things to happen.
You know, as I watch the lap times, I cannot believe how slow these cars are going around this racetrack. We're up in the 23-second bracket. We usually race in the low 22s here, mid-22s, so this car's a good second slower right now in this race than what we normally see here.
Juan Pablo Montoya had problems early, spinning up into the wall in a collision with Johnny Sauter. Krista, for an update.
Well, it actually could have been a lot worse. Kudos to the crew, because they got all that dragging and hanging sheet metal off of there so that the team did not have to come back in a third time, which would have happened under green, and that's what happened to Johnny Sauter. So because they only had to come in two times, they were able to save a little bit of track position and make the adjustments to free up that car just a little bit. But yeah, they were all high-fiving. They took put a silver lining in what was a very bad situation to keep that car out there under green.
The big difference, Montoya is still on the lead lap, while Sauter lost five laps making repairs.
We also need to make note, the only car in the garage area right now is that 31 car of Jeff Burton. Jamie McMurray is back out on the racetrack in the 26 car, 84 laps down after making repairs after having the flat right front.
Ooh, J.J. Ailey skipped up the racetrack in turn one, locked the brake. Teammate Tony Stewart got underneath him and made the pass. Kevin Harvick is your leader, 156 laps in here at Richmond.
Welcome back. NASCAR on Fox in Richmond, Virginia. Moments ago, Denny Hamlin from the state of Virginia overtaking Kevin Harvick to lead. Jimmie Johnson third. Jeff Gordon, the pole sitter, going for his third straight win, currently running fourth. In case you joined us late today, remember this was supposed to be run last night. After a rainout, they start anew. Five laps into the race today. Johnny Sauter, the 70 car, nudging Casey Mears. The lone Hendrick car not having a good year. Jamie McMurray came in seventh in points. A right front tire after he scrapes the wall takes him out. He has since come back, but will fall quite a bit. So will Jeff Burton, who came in second in points and has left the race. Johnny Sauter, a victim again here from Juan Pablo Montoya in the 42. But after a closer look, Ryan Newman in the Altel Dodge tapping Montoya. And that's a different kind of side-by-side racing. And then moments ago, Kevin Harvick, who had had the lead, trying to fight off Denny Hamlin in the 11 car, and Hamlin eventually does pass him to take the lead. Six leaders, 10 lead changes. We've had five cautions so far in the race. Kurt Busch applying the heat there on Jeff Gordon. And Jeff Hamlin, you talked about adjustments. The drivers and teams that do the best today will do the best at the end.
Yeah, and one of the key things about this two car has to be the driver adjustment, because he had the problem early on, got caught up, and he was able to go all the way from the back of the pack. And Larry McReynolds said, hey, he come up through there so fast, he kind of surprised them. Another car, in my opinion, who's made wholesale adjustments has to be Tony Stewart. Again, just recently on one of the last cautions, they were pulling unhooking the rear track bar, making adjustments to the wedge, a lot of things to get this 20 car back on track, and he's already making his way up the 17th position. So, I mean, it's one of those situations where I think the guys who kind of get aggressive early on, Chris, because we're not even halfway yet, they're looking on down to the big picture toward the end of the day.
Anytime you got Gordon, Jimmie Johnson, Harvick up around the top, you know the finish will be exciting. It's almost Saturday baseball. It has been, and it will be 3:30 Eastern, 12:30 Pacific. Comes and fills among some of the matchups you'll see in high definition. Angels and Rangers. Rangers and Tigers, or Rangers and Tigers and Twins, we should say. Don't forget Saturday night following baseball from Darlington, Mother's Day weekend at 7 Eastern, 4 Pacific. Greg Biffle, who won that race last year, making a move here, Mike Joy, currently running sixth.
Thanks, Chris. Biffle has faded back just a little bit. I mean, he's certainly a contender, but Kurt Busch right now is the fastest car on the racetrack. That number two Dodge is about the last 20 laps has been the quickest, and now he's picked up Jimmie Johnson's pace right ahead of him.
Watch this. Man, Kurt Busch, Denny Hamlin there in the 29 car of Harvick. David Reutemann got in her way, and man, Harvick took it three wide. He said, watch this.
But that's what's been happening to these two leaders right now. Harvick's going to go back by him coming off turn two. Is they're in heavy lap traffic now, and each of them start using lap traffic as a pick to get by the other one.
This is going to do is bring Jimmie Johnson and Kurt Busch right to them.
Yeah, Denny's been running the bottom the whole time, and Harvick's been running the top a little bit. I think Denny ought to move up and see if that helps him or not.
I don't think we can say enough about that two car right now with what he's accomplished. As bad as these cars are driving right now, for him to come from 42nd to fourth, just about to battle for third, I guarantee you that car will be a contender. But I go back to Phoenix. He had one of the best cars there 2 weeks ago and got burnt by that late race caution after making a green flag stop.
I'll go back to Texas. Same thing, different verse. I tell you what, the throttle, I've been listening to, we have some sound from the cars. It's amazing how long they're laying out the throttle with these things. Just waiting, 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 trying to get them to turn and get them to go. Listen to Dale Jr. here. He's not wide open. He's not wide open. Finally gets it wide open at the start-finish line just for a brief second. Now, listen how long he coasts. Coast, 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 coast. No throttle. Finally gets a little bit of throttle.
And you can tell a lot of brake. You can hear the motor pull down.
And he's trying to get past his teammate, Martin Truex Jr., the two-time Busch champion. Truex told us yesterday, he says, I can make the chase. He says, oh, yeah. Matt?
And Larry Mack will tell you, Mike, that they've got a great notebook in the last year and a half, and they were using it, even though they've got this new COT. You can see the confidence on their faces, and it's showing in qualified eighth. He's telling Bono on the radio the fact that they made some adjustments in the last stop with track bar and air pressure. That helped, but it didn't last long enough. They need the good to last longer into the run. Steve?
Matt Dale Earnhardt Jr. right behind Martin Truex Jr. now on board. He just told his crew, we had a lot better forward fight at Martinsville and Bristol, also car of tomorrow races. He said it's not real good here.
And guys, this is the longest green run we've had in this race. We're 177 laps into it. Now, most of these guys are going to have to beat a pit road within about the next 20 laps. Biggest problem right now Dale Earnhardt Jr. has, we're looking at it, is that 66 car of Jeff Green back there in the 10th position.
This is so reminiscent to me, and I know fans that will be a little older maybe can remember, when we went to the small car in 81, we had a terrible time trying to get that car to work and get it to handle good. And all we cried about was, we got our best cars back in the shop, we can't run them anymore, the big old Monte Carlo that we were so accustomed to. This car reacts the same way as those little cars did back then.
It's only the fourth race with this car. The teams are still learning what it wants as you get further into a race run.
And just to help the fans understand the principle of this car tomorrow, it's been a five-year project mainly to build a safer race car. The agenda this year is basically to run it at 16 races, all tracks under a mile and a half, the two road courses, and then Talladega, the final restrictor plate race of the year.
Our singular virtual crew chief question. Should all races be run next year with the car tomorrow? Should we just say, okay, no more phase in 2008, right from the gun? Should we use it everywhere? To enter, text the message crew to 191 from your AT&T or singular wireless phone, or go to foxsports.com, keyword singular.
I'd say it wouldn't hurt Hendrick Motorsports' feelings if we just went ahead and run it at all the races next year.
There is the tail of the tape. Look at who has led laps in those three races coming into today.
Well, you know what they're doing, though, is running this car enough this year to get a lot of good feedback It needs to be adjusted before they run it all the time next year. We got the offseason to do it.
Dale Jr. almost got the wall in turn number two. The car would not turn. He skated way up the hill. Now he's got to get his tires cleaned off and get back at it.
Regroup. You're going to see something here today before the day's over that we haven't seen here a long time. These guys are going to be scraping the outside wall, looking for grip.
With the high line around Kenny Wallace.
It's a fine line when you go high down into turn one like that, entering down high. There's a lot of dirt and loose stuff up there. You get over the edge, that's what happens.
When you get up out of the black into the gray, those hot tires, they pick up what we call marbles, which are little pieces of rubber, and it'll make you think you have a flat tire if you can get them cleaned off.
Kevin Harvick leading Denny Hamlin and Jimmie Johnson coming up on Halfway in Richmond.
NASCAR Dexter Cup Racing on Fox is sponsored by Chevy, the most wins in NASCAR history, an American revolution.
Eight laps to halfway in Richmond. Kevin Harvick leading Denny Hamlin and Kurt Busch, who continues to close on the leaders. You're watching from Mark Martin in the Army Chevy in 23rd spot. Casey Kane, right now in 25th position in the Evernham Dodge. He is the subject of our DLP Amazing Moment of the day. Kane scored his first career Nextel Cup win right here, May 14th, 2005. Got congratulated by the fella he beat, the man who had been one of his racing idols in open wheel, Tony Stewart. Last year, Kane won the most races of anyone in Nextel Cup, but Matt, what a difference a year has made.
Mike, what a shocker. Still searching for his first top five finish of 2007. Now they pit it back on lap 148. Casey says the car is starting out so much better, but then it just goes so loose again, sliding both the nose and the rear of the car. But it's better later in the run, so they are making a lot of headway on this number nine Dodge.
I mean, right now, when you look at the Evernham cars, Elliott Sadler is a lap down in that 19 car, had to spin here on the front stretch. Scott Riggs is in 21st, Casey Kane 25th. Those three cars each only have one top 10 per team here in 2007.
Is Kevin Harvick's car going away? Juan Pablo Montoya caught him, passed him on the outside. So is the leader backing up, Steve?
Well, Mike, his refrain, Kevin Harvick's, that is, similar to Dale Earnhardt Jr.'s. He said, I just need more forward bite. They're talking about taking air out of the right rear tire when they stop soon.
It's going to be real soon because, remember, all of our leaders were on pit road at lap 105. That was 90 laps. Now, I think because the pace has slowed down, these guys can go much further on fuel. But what you'll see a chain reaction. Someone will hit pit road knowing they're going to pick up a lot of time, and you're going to see everybody start to follow them to make their stops.
The reason Montoya was racing him so hard, he's trying to stay on the lead lap. Now he wants to try to be the first car one lap down to get the free pass if he can.
Which he knows he's got to stay right there with the leaders because Harvick is really starting to pick them up and lay them down as far as lapping cars.
And I think it says a lot for this car. We were all concerned about how fragile it might be, and that car's been in the wall pretty hard, and here he is still running some decent lap times.
But, you know, as we approach the halfway point, we saw Robbie Gordon burnt by pit road speed, 40 miles per hour. You have a green flag stop here, it feels like you're crawling on pit road. You can't afford a speeding penalty.
I'm not coming to pit road. I say it every time it happens. Y'all always talk about short pit. Don't talk to me about short pit. I want to be the last one on pit road, not the first.
You want to come when you need fuel. You have to have fuel.
I don't want to depend on the caution to help me, and I don't want to depend on one to hurt me.
Here comes one of the first of the lead lap cars to pit road, David Strimme in the 40 car. He was running back in the 17th position. This will be a scheduled stop for this 40 car.
Having a look at our fourth and fifth place cars, Jimmie Johnson and pole sitter Jeff Gordon. Let's go to Gordon's pit and Matt.
Mike, the DuPont guys putting their helmets on, getting ready to service Gordon coming up here shortly. Jeff telling Steve Letarte that the car is not horrible on entry, but it is just so super tight in the center. And then it just snaps. It just changes directions in a hurry. Steve Letarte telling Jeff, the brakes look great because remember, they've got pistol number one. He's got a great view of this 24 car in entry. Steve?
Carl Edwards now exiting pit road. He said that his tires were chattering so badly in the center of the corner that he had to keep his left side tires on the apron just to get it to turn. Meanwhile, Dale Earnhardt Jr. on pit road, they've been chasing the same problem all day long. They can't get it to turn, and he's a little bit free when he exits the turn. His service is done.
Scott Riggs is in, so is Kyle Petty and Martin Truex. Here comes David Ragan, who's had a good run in the top 20, as we watch the race for second place on the left of your screen.
That two-car Kurt Busch is so good on long runs right now. There you see him pulling right up to the rear bumper of Denny Hamlin in the 11 car. This is a battle for second right now.
Matt?
Track bar and air pressure adjustment on the previous stop for Martin Truex Jr. The tires going on the left side. Needed more of the same. They made an air pressure adjustment again. He just needs that good of that race car to last longer to the run.
The first of the top five cars comes to pit road. Jeff Gordon peels off in fifth place to pit his DuPont Chevy.
Watch the cars when they get into their pit box. Watch how the rear tires lock up first. That means they got a lot of rear brake in these cars, if you see that.
And that's the reason these guys have actually, for the first time I can remember, having rear brake problems, Matt.
And the 24 stops right at the sign. Very first pit stall on pit road. Steve Letarte calling for a track bar adjustment as Caleb Hurd grabs a second can of fuel as Gilman comes around. Great stop going on so far. Great stop.
Back on lap 184, Denny Hamlin said his car is doing the same thing. Tight in the center, loose off. They're going to make another slight track bar adjustment and an air pressure adjustment. The Virginia native hoping he finds victory lane at his home track.
Steve.
Kevin Harvick on pit road, Mike. And again, he says, I need more forward fight up off the turns. Jason Pulver changing the front tires. Air out of the right rear. Dick.
Before pit stops began, Kyle Busch had gone from 34th all the way up to 6th to a car that's tight in the center. Loose off. He's so happy in the car. A moment ago, he was laughing on the radio. Steve.
Dick, Kurt Busch continues his march to the front after restarting 42nd. Now, he is saying that his car is tight in the center, but very loose off. They're making a chassis adjustment right now. They will also make an air pressure adjustment on the two car of Kurt Busch.
What that did, that handed the lead to his teammate Ryan Newman in the 12 car, has not made his pit stop. Tony Stewart, the 20, is second. Now, here comes Newman to make his scheduled green flag stop.
Krista?
And it's like he heard you guys. Ryan Newman coming to pit road for four tires, fuel, and a round of wedge out of his Alltel Dodge.
But Tony Stewart should lead this lap, but Stewart is going to bring the Home Depot Chevy to pit lane as well.
Well, he's got to be a happy camper because that car was junk, and man, they really tuned it up.
He restarted 37th at lap 125 and came to the lead, which is now held by Matt Kenseth with Stewart on pit road.
Now, fuel-wise, Matt Kenseth can go a little further than these guys right here because Matt made that pit stop back on lap 120. Now, that means that they're going to give up a lot of time on tires, though, Matt.
So many changes for that 20 car. The only thing they didn't do was just turn it upside down and shake it. You've heard Zippy talk about the significant adjustments, and Tony says it has helped the race car. Still needs a turn better, but we are making huge headway on this 20 machine, and he's away.
Well, all the things they did to that car will definitely tighten it up. Lowering that track bar on the left side, unhooking that rear sway bar, taking a rubber out. That's the adjustments we were talking about when the race started.
Right now, what Robbie Reiser, Matt Kenseth are banking on that 17 car, they're banking on a caution because right now as the leader, he's running mid-23s. These guys that just made these stops that have fresh tires, mid-22s, he's giving up. You can see him waving right there, guys. Great move right there. I'm going to pit road this time. It's a veteran driver.
Steve?
Mike, the report on Matt Kenseth, just like we've heard for so many cars, he is tight in the center as he hits pit road. They have made, or already made, the air pressure adjustment prior to his stop. But again, tight in the center for Matt Kenseth.
Thanks, Steve. You're watching Mark Martin. He is the leader. And I believe he will be the last or next to last lead lap car to make a stop. looking also for the four of Ward Burton, who is now in the pit lane, and here comes Mark. So this will complete green flag stop.
I think the only other car that has not been to pit road just yet is Ricky Rudd in the 88 car. He's still out there. Again, Butch Hilton, his crew chief, they're up in the top 10. They wish they could get a caution right now.
Krista?
For Mark Martin, it's just a quarter round up on the track bar plus four tires and fuel. Remember, Mark Martin has not raced in as many Car of Tomorrow races as his competitors, this being just his second one.
We should cycle back to Kevin Harvick as the race leader. And you're watching on the left what will be the battle for third place, or perhaps fourth. Make it fourth place. Kurt Busch and Denny Hamlin.
Yeah, Harvick really, they had a great pit stop, Larry, and he really put some distance on Jeff Gordon and these other guys running second, third, and fourth.
And who actually had a great pit stop? Alan Gustafson in that five group for Kyle Busch, because they moved up to second through this cycle of green flag stops. But a lot had to do who came to pit road first and got those fresh tires and got advantage on the stopwatch.
I think Harvick's got the best overall car. It's pretty good on new tires, and it stays pretty good right to the end.
Those old boys are doing a job on pit road for him, too.
And they're helping him all they can.
One driver who did not fare well on pit road, Jeff Green. His number 66 had a tough stop that's dropped him off the lead lap, Matt.
And Larry Mack, you've said it so many times. You can have a great run, but the thing, just don't beat yourself. Issues on pit road, a misstep, they lost a lug nut. Jeff Green forced to come back to pit road. A great run going today. Now they've got a lot of work to do to try to get their team back in position to capitalize on another top 10 finish in a COT race.
And it just emphasizes, Matt, how important the total package is. What makes Jeff Gordon great? He has a great car, he has a great pit crew. It takes it all to be successful at this level.
So we've completed pit stops at 217 laps. Kevin Harvick out front of Kyle Busch, Jeff Gordon the pole sitter, Kurt Busch, and hometown favorite Denny Hamlin. You're riding with Ward Burton in the Morgan McClure number four, one of the Virginia-based teams out in Abington. You note the Virginia Tech below the visor on Ward's helmet. Going to auction off that helmet to help benefit the Memorial Fund at Virginia Tech. Elliott Sadler involved in a very similar auction. Sadler's helmet's up over $6,000 right now.
And as we look at Ward sitting in there, I know you look at folks at home are probably saying, man, look how close he is to that steering wheel. There's a really good reason for that. He's resting his arm here on the steering wheel. You see this arm here, he just moved it. He's resting that on the steering wheel as he goes through the corner. This is a very physically demanding racetrack. And just think about folks at home. Take 10 pounds and put it in your hands and see where you can hold it up the longest. Up next to you, inside your body, or way out in front of you?
We've been talking about front and rear brake. What Ward just did on the straightaway, if you notice this red knob right here, he just adjusted the bias between the front and rear. If his car's getting a little bit loose getting in, you can crank more front brake in it. If it's not turning, you can crank rear brake in it. That's one of the adjustments that a driver can do from the cockpit of the race car. If you notice, he had to do it in a hurry. You're not on the straightaways long here.
Kevin Harvick continues to lead. Ward Burton, one of four or five drivers from the state of Virginia, will get you a list. And this is the first Nextel Cup race in the state since the Virginia Tech tragedy. Foremost in the minds of a lot of folks on pit road and in the garage area. Krista?
Well, we know how close Ward Burton is to the campus, but there's another reason he carries the colors. One of the team's engineers, Blake Ray, is a student at Virginia Tech. In fact, he finished his classes. He's a senior. He will graduate next week. Now, he was not on campus the day of the shooting. He was actually competing in an engineering competition in Florida. He did not have any classes this semester in Norris Hall, but he said he knew several students who did. He has since gone back to work. He said the support he has gotten from his teammates has been absolutely incredible. Matt Yoakam?
If you go to the town of Stewart, Virginia, which is only about an hour and 20 minutes from Blacksburg, you can walk around the town and all you see is Virginia Tech Hokie maroon and orange. Especially if you stop by the old Wood Brothers shops for years, Leonard Wood, who now works on carburetors out of the Roush stable, his daughter Beth attended Virginia Tech. Also Delano, another legendary Wood Brother, his daughter Deanna, she attended Virginia Tech. The entire town of Stewart, Virginia, all big Hokie fans. So when the tragedy hit, you could feel it all the way the 60 miles from Blacksburg to
Chris Stewart. Steve?
Well, Matt, brothers Ward Burton and Jeff Burton from South Boston, Virginia. Elliot Sadler from Emporia, Virginia. Denny Hamlin from nearby Chesterfield. They are so deeply moved by the tragedy. Last night before the race, they donated a total of $120,000 to Frank Beamer, the head football coach at Virginia Tech. And that's to help the families and to help create and establish a memorial on campus.
At Hendrick Motorsports, Brian Weitzel, Darian Grubb, Caleb Hurd, all engineering graduates of Virginia Tech. So the Tech tragedy cut very deeply through the heart of NASCAR and is uppermost in our minds.
It's been so neat to see the outpouring of support, though, from the NASCAR community to the victims up there.
Tony Stewart just went past Dale Earnhardt Jr. and moved up to eighth place. So it's been quite a drive from back to front, and that's why earlier we said they didn't mind spending all that time on pit road, making two stops, restarting at the back. They knew that they and Tony could get Big Orange back up to the front.
Jeff Hammond talked about this adjustment this team made. Again, that was just a little over 100 laps ago. They knew they were not going to be able to win the race with what they had. They took the bullet on lap 120 by unhooking that rear sway bar, and now they're on the march to the front and actually looking pretty respectable depending on where they're at in traffic on the stopwatch.
But here goes our leader now, Kevin Harvick. He's at the line now, and as I look across the racetrack, Tony Stewart is going down the back straightaway, so he's in good position, but he's a half lap behind the leader as well.
He needs a caution to get caught back up.
To get totally caught up, he does.
Well, the last caution flag was 138 laps ago. We've had pit stops since, of course, and we're well on our way to going through another round of green flag stops.
And it's so funny, Mike, as I made my walk through the garage area yesterday morning and asked crew chiefs, how far can you go on fuel? A lot of them said, you know, we really don't pay attention to it here because, you know what, we never get green flag runs. I told them, I said, trust me, the middle part of this Richmond race, we always have a green flag run. It just, everything kind of sorts out.
Somebody's not doing their homework if they don't know we have long green flag runs here, because we have trouble early, we have trouble late, but the middle is a couple of good long
just
green flag
seeing.
Stops. Yeah.
Pole sitter Jeff Gordon there in fifth, Matt.
Mike, you can definitely hear the frustration in Jeff Gordon's voice. He came on the radio moments ago and said, whatever we did, we have really changed the handling of our race car. Now it's so tight in the center and so loose on exit. And it's happening so early in the run. Mike, he said, that means we are going to be in for some big-time trouble if we don't fix it and fix it fast.
And, Matt, I think this track is going through a little bit of a change, too. It's really getting rubbered back in now after all the rubber being washed off.
Well, let's check our singular virtual crew chief question and see what those of you at home thought. About the car of tomorrow, 65% of you say yes, 2008. Let's just transition and run this car at all the tracks. We talked to Mike Helton, NASCAR's president, yesterday, and he told us that they are polling the car owners and talking with them each week after this car is run, and probably before we leave the air at Dover in June, we may have a decision from NASCAR whether or not that will happen next year. And Mike said they're relying very heavily on the input from the car owners.
We'll have a lot more information. We race it at two out of the next three racetracks. We run it at Darlington, we run it at Dover, so we'll have more information.
Kevin Harvick, your leader at 244 laps in Richmond.
Racing on Fox is sponsored by State Farm. Great service, great rates. Nobody takes care of you like State Farm. By Gillette Deodorant Triple Protection Technology for Men. By Burger King, who reminds you to have it your way. And by the Comcast Triple Play, the best in TV, phone, and internet.
Saturday Baseball returns. Coverage begins at 3:30 Eastern, 12:30 Pacific for your game of the week.
And Don't forget, we're here for pit stops. Caution out the 18, J.J. Yaley against the wall, bringing out the sixth caution in today's race. Let's check in and Steve Burns.
Well, Chris, Kevin Harvick just got service. I'm just listening on the radio. He about ran into, I believe, the two car on pit road. They may have made contact. Matt.
Service already complete for Jimmie Johnson, as well as just about everybody else. Now, Johnson said his car was a little free late in the run. Chad Knaus fixing that with a slight chassis adjustment. Jimmy also said that as the sixth car, David Reagan has spun in pit. You can see the contact there with the 29 of Kevin Harvick on the right front. The brakes were getting hot for the 48 of Jimmie Johnson. Mike?
Kevin Harvick and Kurt Busch were exiting their pit as David Reagan was coming in. And Reagan had a sudden snap spin. Watch this.
Okay, now, whose fault would this be right here? In my mind, you got to put it on the shoulders of the crew chief and the spotter for the 29. They see that six car coming in. Kevin Harvick can't see it when you're in there with that head and neck restraint device, but Steve, they've worked to do on that 29 car.
Yeah, you're right, Larry Mack. And Kevin said, is anybody paying attention? He said, this car is killed on the right front now. So that answers or talks to your comment about paying attention. He said the tow out is really bad on that Chevrolet.
And it's not that Todd Barrier doesn't have a good view. His war wagon is the tallest one on pit road.
And again, the spotter, that's something the spotter has to do for these guys.
All right, we got to go. Get out of the way. Get out of the way. We got to go.
The spotter has a good view of this pit road.
Oh, me.
And this is where it just starts getting worse from here.
It does.
Well, what does that do to your entry into turn one with a nose like that?
I think probably the bigger issue is the chassis damage that they may have suffered, the tow, getting that fixed where he can drive the car.
There you see the spotters, and actually the 29 pit is right in the middle of pit road, so spotter had a great view of that. He just let his guard down for a second.
You know, accidentally or not, as Kevin Harvick is too fast exiting, he'll be back. David Reagan, accidentally or not, did a nice job of spinning that car right into his pit box, and he was in the box legally, so they did the stop with him facing the wrong way.
They got a little practice for their Watkins Glen pit stop here early in May.
NASCAR Nextel Cup Racing on Fox is sponsored by UPS, the official delivery company of NASCAR.
UPS delivers the chance to manage your own free fantasy auto racing league at foxsports.com. A miscue for Kevin Harvick trying to leave his pit. Now, here is the pit of the 29. He was trying to beat the two of Kurt Busch while the six pitted here, David Reagan, was coming onto pit road. First, from the driver's perspective.
Okay, Darryl. My job is when I get my car in the pit box, when that left side tire change is done and they drop that jack, the jack dropping is my cue to go. Unless I hear my crew chief say, stop, not whoa, don't say whoa, 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 because I think
like
it's got to be stop. And somewhere along the way, the communication broke down.
And, Jeff, I think it's where the crew chief and the spotter, regardless of how you do it, you have to have a system.
You've got to have a system, Larry. My system was five pits away, the crew chief has got it because he's got the best view to count the driver the rest of the way in. And while the crew chief is responsible is because on that left side of the car, the spotter can't see it. But he said the crew chief's got to be looking up pit road, and bang, he should have been saying, stop, stop, stop. It's not important to beat the two car off pit road right now. It's not to get wrecked on pit road. Don't beat yourself.
And that's what they were caught up in. I think that's what the whole focus of everybody was on right there. Let's beat Kurt Busch, that two car off pit road, and they lost sight of what happened.
You see, everybody's looking not at the cars coming in.
Getting ready for the restart. Kurt Busch got out of his pit clean. He is the race leader.
Well, and rightfully so. I mean, he had a fast car, and he was coming up to, he was going to challenge Kevin eventually, so I think that's why there was the urgency in the pits.
And just remember, let's go back. Kurt Busch, 150-something laps ago, was back in about 42nd after being involved in that first lap crash.
Kurt Busch works his way back up to the lead. How about exercise that surround sound of yours? Let's crank it up for a few laps. 37 laps to go, and in traffic, Tony Stewart made a nifty move and split his teammates three wide in turn one to get past them. And then Denny Hamlin got past Tony to move up into the sixth place a lap ago.
Yeah, they're three wide right here. Look at them. There's 11, the 20, and the 18. All three coming off the corner side by side.
And J.D. Gibbs is gasping right
there. Yeah, right. It all sorted out just fine. So Kurt Busch in a Dodge is the race leader. He's followed by six Chevys led by Jimmie Johnson. The first Ford and the best Ford in the race most of the day, Greg Biffle in eighth. And the leading Toyota, Dave Blaney, as he has been all day, he's in 15th place.
One of those Roush Fords back there, Darrell and I have been talking about it, Matt Kenseth in that 17 car, he's back there in the 10th position. Robbie Reiser, they elected to make a pit stop every time they got a chance in the beginning of the race, and they just kept, a lot like Tony Stewart and Greg Zipidelli, they just kept making that car better. Right now he's in the top 10.
When we talk about things happening quietly, you need a picture of Matt Kenseth, because he quietly eases his way into the picture.
And what you won't see is a picture of Kyle Busch, because that number five has been slice and dice all day long, but he's got it up to third place.
He has incentive right now. His brother's leading the race, and they have a real rivalry between the two of them. They'd like to bushwhack this whole field.
And right now we have those Hendrick guys. They're running second, third, and fourth. Jimmie Johnson, Kyle Busch, Jeff Gordon. Like we've seen a lot this year, especially at the car tomorrow races.
300 cars, second, third, and fourth. Here are the top Fords in the race. Two from Roush Fenway Racing and David Gilliland for Robert Yates. And each of them have improved greatly from where they started the day.
Well, there's about four or five really, really good race cars, and then there's a whole bunch of mediocre race cars.
This has definitely been a good day for Greg Biffle in that 16 car. He's been up there in the top 10. Somebody not happy with what someone was doing out on the racetrack.
I think that was
like Steve Meehl.
Steve Meehl, yeah. It was
Dale Jr.
Junior spotter was going to go talk to the 96, I'm thinking.
Tony Raines, that 96 car, right now he's a lap down back in the 20th position.
Jeff Gordon started from the pole, now running in fourth. He's been a top five car just about all day, but Matt, is he frustrated now being behind his two teammates?
Mike, they changed just about everything on the race car except unhook the rear bar like the 20 team did. Now, you documented that we've had some long green flag runs, and that's exactly what Steve Letarte had told his driver. We've got probably one more stop, so hopefully this will get us in the ballpark so when we make our last pit stop, you can tell us exactly what you need to get back that small little window of magic that we had earlier in the race.
Now, that rear bar is a crutch. You use that in an impound race particularly because it helps you qualify good, and you have the option in the racing of unhooking it, and that will help tighten the car back up. So it's one of those little adjustments that you try to use qualifying, maybe you don't need in a race.
So right now it's Penske with a Dodge in front. Hendrick Chevy's second, third, and fourth. And Joe Gibbs Chevrolet's in fifth and sixth. Krista?
This car has been the exact same all day long, and that's not necessarily a great thing, although he has to have a great car because the drive off is not getting any better. He said it is exactly the same. They took some wedge out on that last stop to try to free it up, and remember, Denny Hamlin is wearing his heart on his helmet this week. Justin Griffith of the Children's Hospital of Richmond designed the helmet that Denny is wearing. Denny is trying to win this race for himself and for little Justin.
Yeah, Chris, I guess he's going to wear a helmet that's painted by or designed by one of the children at the Children's Hospital in 11 different races. There you see the helmet that Krista was just talking about.
This is for him like playing in your backyard. When the kid grew up here and what a thrill it'd be for him if he could win this race. He's got a little work to do if he is going to make that happen today, but boy, it's like a home track advantage.
We got trouble. David Gilliland in the 38 car hard at the inside wall. The caution will fly.
He's at the inside of the entrance of turn three.
There's a spot back there where it seems like every car that spins off of turn two ends up in that hole back there where the safety vehicles come out.
But you know, Darrell, normally when you end up that far down the straightaway, I almost get a feeling, I'm sure we'll have replays, that maybe somebody gave you a little bit of a punt.
Well, let's look at our DLP Ultimate Picture Cam and see what it saw. It's Johnny Benson on the outside of Gilliland. He gets into Benson.
Yeah, he just drove up in there and hit Benson in the left rear. The car just pushed with him, didn't have enough front grip. Now watch this thing go right in that hole. Every time they spin back there, they go right in that hole.
Once again, I want to keep making note, that hard of lick, that rear wing still stayed attached to that deck lid.
That was just Gilliland really, I think he must have lost front grip when the car just pushed right into Benson. You can see him kind of sliding up off the corner there.
We've seen that off turn two all weekend long. Your car just loses grip and you just run out of racetrack. In the case there, he ran out of racetrack because the car was there.
Here comes the leader, Kurt Busch, who won here in September of 05, the last of the 14 wins that he earned in Jack Roush's Fords. Steve?
And Mike, as he hit pit road and got down this lane, he said nobody pitted with us. He also told his crew, this is where we make our money, boys. He said he's loose in, tighten the center and loose off. He also said, Mike, this is the worst that he has been at this point in the race.
David Gilliland got out of his car. He is okay after that crash.
I believe I'd have got me some tires like some of these other guys did.
Looks like about half of our lead lap cars pitted.
A lot of different strategies employed. We'll review when we return.
NASCAR Nextdoor Cup Racing on Fox is sponsored by Toyota. Moving forward. The Jim Stewart 400 presented by Crown Royal, and Jimmie Johnson currently leading Kyle Busch, but Kurt Busch, who pitted, trying to work his way back up 40 races since his last Cup win. Jeff Hammond, let's see how pit stops have affected some big names today.
Well, you take a look here at Tony Stewart. Car was really ill-handling. They came down, unhooked the rear sway bar, and it's really helped Tony. He's got himself back up now in the top five. Now, Dale Earnhardt Jr. running really strong early in the race. If you don't believe the NASCAR stock car races and team sport, these guys cost him an opportunity to be leading this race and slid him in the back. Now watch what happens to Kevin Harvick. Gets into the sixth car of David Ragan while he was the leader. I mean, you've got to have better communication. Pit road is going to wind up winning somebody the race today or cost him the race.
Thanks, Jeff. Getting set for the restart. Jimmie Johnson's out front. The first of seven cars that did not pit. Martin Truex, there he is in the number one. In eighth place, the first of the cars that did pit.
Yeah, of our 18 cars on the lead lap, 10 of them elected to come to pit road. It had been 16 laps since they were on pit road the last time.
There's a car pretty far back in there. Kevin Harvick's car is banged up, but I've been watching his lap times. If he can get back up there, he's got a car that might still be able to win this race.
And he was one of the cars that made a pit stop that time for four tires.
I was worried about bending the chassis or the tie rods or something, but I think you're okay.
Teammates fight for the lead.
Oh,
trouble behind them.
Dale Earnhardt Jr. in the 8 car. I'm not sure I don't think he hit anything.
He didn't. He just spun her out.
But that was a 4-car gaggle. And you see the damage to the left rear wheel well of Jr.
Now, Jr. was one of those cars that made a pit stop as well.
See what happened here. He says he got run into.
There he is on the right of the screen.
66, he's got his tires tires locked up smoking, but he goes right up into Dale Jr.
That's not the first time we've seen a situation like that.
And you know, it just tells you they can't get any grip in those front tires. There's a perfect indication of it. Put the brakes on, the car doesn't go down and lock up. It just slides right up the hill like it's on ice.
But with him being in the middle of the pack, pretty lucky no one got into him.
I'll see
Matt Kenseth in the 17, not sure which way he wants to go.
Well, he
right
doesn't
there.
Have any idea where Junior is. He just listened to his spotter, I'm sure, right there.
Kept those wheels spinning, kept the car off the wall. Let's ride with Dale Jr.
Just a little touch.
From Carl Edwards.
See the 66 up there with the tires locked up.
Slow it down. Come low. Come down the middle. Come on.
That's about all he could do was just stop and wait.
Boy, but you saw Matt Kenseth cut it left and get out of town in a hurry. And did. Well, who will pit under this caution? We'll tell you when we come back. 110 laps to go. Jimmie Johnson, the race leader. Fox 3D shows you what happened to car number 8, Dale Earnhardt Jr. A bump from Jeff Green, and he keeps it off the wall, and everyone avoids him. They've cleaned up the caution. We're going back to Green. 19 cars on the lead lap, including J.J. Yaley, who got the free pass.
Boy, Jimmie Johnson didn't get a very good restart. I thought Kyle Busch was going to hop to the outside, and he is. I don't know if he can make that pass or not, but Jimmy kind of spun the tires and left the outside wide open.
Kyle got a pretty good bite off turn 2, but he can't quite get beside his teammate. He really drove her down into 3 that time, though.
His brother Kurt was leading this race, now finds himself in 9th place as Kyle hunts the lead from teammate Jimmie Johnson.
Jimmy's car is just really, really hanging the bottom well. I mean, he accelerates up out of the corner good. As long as he's got the whole racetrack, he's in pretty good shape. Lets it come off here and run all the way out to the wall. That's what you want to do. Good lap times.
Hendrick Motorsports, 1, 2, 3. The Gibbs Chevrolet's 4th and 5th. Matt?
Still waiting for their fuel window open for leader Jimmie Johnson, but he did tell Chad Knaus the last change is about 8% of the 20% he needs. And DW, you've made up a great point. The 48 is just awesome on the bottom, but Jimmy says he's not quite as good up top. That's why he's hanging it down on the bottom.
Yeah, man, I mean, he's got that left side tire right on that yellow line, and he is eating it up.
Yeah, he's been one of the cars that I have not seen in the 294 laps that we've run so far that has been very far off the bottom.
And you can do that as long as you've got the whole racetrack to use. Now, here we see him experiment a little bit. He's going to say, let me try that high line, and now look what it did for him.
Kyle Busch in the 5 car, he'll lead that lap right there. But Jimmie Johnson fights back on the high side, getting into turn 1.
I think a deal was made.
I think, Dick, that was a gimme, was it?
I don't know if that was a gimme or not. He did ask for that, but it was quite a while ago that he asked for that. So if it was a gimme, it was a long time coming. I can tell you that Kyle Busch was very surprised on the last round of pit stops because his crew had been listening to the other team and who was going to stay out. And one of the guys who was going to stay out was brother Kurt Busch. And when Kurt pitted, Kyle drove by and said, well, how about that? He was very surprised that his brother pitted, and they are worried about the guys behind him that have 4 fresh tires.
Teammates working together, Mike. Chad Knaus simply said on the radio, that was very kind of you.
It really was. I don't know that it was planned or not, but it certainly it was obvious that they did it on purpose.
What I did notice, that very next time down the back straightaway, Kyle gave a wave out the left window like, thank you, teammate.
Well, Kyle Busch right now is 7th in the Nextel Cup standings, and by leading that lap, he picked up 5 bonus points. And you never know when we come back here in Richmond how important 5 points could be as to whether or not you make the chase for the Nextel Cup.
And Mike, you talked
car in the wall, turn 2, Nemechek.
Just would not turn. Car went straight up the hill, and now he's going to get run over.
Hold your line there, hold your line.
And that's happened to him several times today in that 13 car, but we do stay green.
I got a right front tire down or something.
I think he was just, he's been locking the tires up a lot. He must have had a problem with that tire.
Coming to you.
No caution. We will stay green. Watch the 13 of Nemechek. His teammate Marlin right behind.
Definitely was a tire down on the right front. He just can't get it to turn at all.
He did go up there and kiss the wall just a little bit.
Now you saw he did drop a bit of debris, but that is way up and out of the racing groove. NASCAR deemed it not to be a hazard, and we stay green.
Got a battle for 6th place here between Greg Biffle and that 16 car, Martin Truex Jr. in the 1 car. These guys been going at it a few laps.
It's a good day for Greg Biffle, though, and this is one of the best runs he's had lately, and
He says that team really is starting to gel.
Now, we're riding with Denny Hamlin. Mike, you made the point a while ago. We have the Hendrick cars 1, 2, 3. We have Gibbs 4 and 5. Those three Hendrick cars, they won all three car tomorrow races. But those two Gibbs cars, they should have won 2 or 3 of those car tomorrow races and had their issues with the fuel pump cable, pit road speeding, a lot of issues with the Gibbs cars that had good cars.
Yeah, they've led a high percentage of the laps they've been on the racetrack. Stewart and Hamlin now running 4th and 5th.
Hamlin right now, he definitely has his hands full of Martin Truex Jr. in that one car. You know, we sat down with Martin yesterday, and he said every time we go to the racetrack with the car tomorrow, we think it's going to be really bad, but it's always much better than we think. He's obviously run good. He was one of those guys that got burnt by the caution flag at Phoenix. We got battle for second place now between these two teammates.
Another car, turn two, Casey Kane this time.
I think he made contact with David Strumme. I think he and Strumme got together.
He's really slow down the back straight.
Well, he's got some pretty serious damage here. You can see the right front all bowed out.
But he, right side damage, right front, right rear.
Oh, yeah. He will make it to pit road, and again, no caution. That's okay. Let's have a look here.
David Strumme in the 40 car.
It's all the way out against the wall. Strumme, as you can see him, almost rubbing the wall. And the 9 just keeps coming up, up, up. Yeah, they made serious contact right there. Probably a whole lot more damage to the 9 than it was to the 40.
And David Strumme in the 40 was running in the 10th position, still on the lead lap in the top 10.
This has happened to Strumme a lot this year. Be having a great run, and something will happen late.
That was a pretty hard lick on that 40. You're right.
Both cars.
Clear, clear, clear all around.
Casey Kane has taken his car to the garage.
Yeah, that was a lot of damage to the right front of that 9 car. I'm surprised Strumme isn't in the garage.
We stay green with 94 laps to go. Jimmie Johnson, not the quickest car on the racetrack at this moment. Jeff Gordon likely is. He and Kyle Busch are about to fight here for second spot.
Stop, victory lane.
To go, caution has just waved for 3 in turn 1. Last caution at lap 286. We're now at 317, and you're looking at Casey Kane, who is the 4th driver out of the race.
We've heard Matt Yoakum talk about the window here with 83 laps to go. Everyone will come to pit road this time, 4 tires and fuel. This is where I think this race could be won or lost right here on pit road. This could be the final stop.
We've seen enough cars going up the hill down here in turn 1. Sooner or later, we had to get some debris up there.
David Strumme had just been lapped by Jimmie Johnson. Strumme will get the free pass.
I think he'll be glad to get to the pits, do a little work.
Suspension bits? Not sure. Dick Bergman.
Well, Kyle Busch has struggled with a car that's been pushing in the middle of the corner all day, but in these last few runs, he has been happier with it than he has been all day. This will be 4 tires and fuel and the final stop of the day. Krista.
Denny Hamlin's car was loose on that last run. He also said he's not getting off the corner as good as he would like, so they're going to do a quarter round. Make that a very heavy quarter round up on the right rear. Matt.
Track bar adjustment already completed for Jimmie Johnson's team. Meanwhile, Jeff Gordon says they need to still make wholesale changes if they're going to get this car into victory lane, even though they're running second when the caution came out, Steve.
Matt, Kurt Busch and the 2 trying to fight back. He just said, we're loose, we have no track position, and don't we need fuel? The answer, 10-4, come on down. He said he was also loose on exit, so they make a wedge adjustment.
All right, Dave Blaney, Kevin Hamlin, they must have watched Brandon Thomas in the 96 car earlier because they were on pit road about 25 laps ago. They decided to go with 2 right side tires.
So Blaney pops up to 3rd in the race off pit road. Can the best Dodges in this race, Ryan Newman and Kurt Busch, get to the front? Can the fastest Fords, Greg Biffle and Matt Kenseth, make any inroads on the lead? How about Dave Blaney's 2-tire Toyota strategy? Blaney's in 3rd. Or will it be one of those Hendrick or Gibbs Chevrolets? We're about to find out.
The plot thickens.
and the pace picks up.
And you know that move on two tires on Blaney, it's not going to be a race-winning move. But you know what? It may buy him a better finish than he was going to have. Still here on the lead lap with 78 laps to go.
Yeah, that's, you know, with everybody around me on four tires, I'd be a little nervous.
Blaney's in third behind Jimmie Johnson and Jeff Gordon. Just ahead of Kyle Busch, Denny Hamlin, Martin Truex, and Tony Stewart. Nice stop for Matt Kenseth.
He had a great 14th.
Yeah, came out ninth.
He had a great stop. I watched him, man. They were smoking him.
Robbie Reiser's Killer Bees.
They always rise to the occasion when it counts.
Got a battle for third right now. Kyle Busch in the 5 car pulls to the inside of Dave Blaney in the 22. He'll take that position away. So we're back to Hendrick 1-2-3 right now.
Krista?
Dave Blaney is very conscious of points. Remember, they missed last week in Talladega. They're trying to battle their way back into the top 35 in points. The car has been loose, then tight, then loose again. So they went ahead and went with that two-tire gamble. The Caterpillar Toyota running for points.
Well, we'll keep note, Krista and Darrell. He was 13th when he pitted, so we'll see how this strategy plays out.
I think it's going to look really kind of handsome for a while. Then I don't know about the end result. Of course, if they keep running over each other like I see a lot of them doing, they might catch enough cautions to make it work.
That's Reed Sorensen on the outside of Denny Hamlin. Sorensen one lap down in 21st.
Tell you one
thing. Locks the brake.
These cars, all these cars out there today are... they are beaten up like I don't think I've ever seen them before. Sides knocked in, damage everywhere.
What this allowed Tony Stewart to do in that 20 car, he was able to get to the inside of Martin Truex Jr. to one. This is a battle right now for the sixth position. Now Tony gets boxed in behind Reed Sorensen in the 41.
And that's the problem when you have a car that you can't move around. If, you know, you just got to run the bottom. Got to be able to move up the hill here and get by this 41 car.
Tell you what, Kyle Busch in that 5 car, he continues his march to the front. Yep. He pulls up side by side his teammate, Jeff Gordon, here in the 24 car, but had to fall back in line.
He's using up his right rear tire right now.
No team orders at Hendrick Motorsports. Get what you can get. They have the first 3 cars, but they're in a pitched battle for it.
Boy.
Start looking on, Gordon's crew chief, as Jeff surrenders second to Kyle Busch.
Tell you what, Steve Letarte, he is really coming to his own just in his second full year as crew chief for Jeff Gordon at 24 car.
I think it's fascinating the pictures we see of him when he was a little kid. Well, he never was a little kid. When he was a young man sweeping floors back at the shop when he first came to work at Hendrick Motorsports.
Yeah, before he even went to work there, he mowed Ray Evernham's grass at his house.
Those are stories we used to hear back in the old days. Cale Yarborough worked at Holman Moody, sweeping floors, and people go to work in shops hoping to get a chance.
And now they're looking at talent in quarter midget and go-kart races, signing young kids to development contracts as drivers. It's all changed. 3 wide, turn 2, and Tony Stewart comes out on the wrong end of that one. He got car in the wall, turn 2.
A.J. Allmendinger, the 84 car.
No caution.
We stay green.
You know, this place is starting to look like Darlington. Go to turn 2, bounce it off the wall, keep going.
These cars are beaten to pieces, I'm telling you.
We'll be in Darlington next Saturday night on Fox.
That's going to be wild.
Watch the 84 of Allmendinger.
Just gets up there high. Once you do, you see the front end kind of dip down, hard on the brakes, and the thing gets in that gray stuff up there. Nothing but dirt, rubber, debris, and he just bounced it off the wall.
Scott Riggs in the 10 car, he's coming to pit road. Scott right now one lap down, but he'll go more down now.
I think old Smoke was getting a little irritated, wasn't he, Matty?
DW, I think if you put it quietly, the fact that he wanted some consideration from the nice young man in the 41 machine. Finally got it, though. He needed some help with the forward bite as well. But what a rebound. Mike, you talked about it earlier. Almost all the way back to 40th. Now they've hunkered down, got themselves into a good points-paying position for today. Remember, this team still has
has yet to win an event in 2007.
And guys, we know what's wrong with Scott Riggs. Chris DeVoter just told me he's out of brakes. Now, it looks like they've done a little work on it. They're sending him back out. But with 65 laps to go, it's going to be a long 65 laps for him.
Now, when Stewart said he wanted a little consideration, the 41 was a lap down. He's not required to move out of the way, but if he gives Tony a little room, you know, someday the situation might be reversed. He might want a little help.
The problem was the 41 and the 1 were running side by side, and the 41 was on the bottom of the racetrack. He couldn't do anything, and Tony would like for him to just check up and let him go by, and he finally did.
Debris back straightaway puts us under caution for the 10th time today.
I think you bounce these things off the wall enough, Larry. You can finally knock some pieces off of them.
I'm sure there were some guys back in the pack that wanted to see this caution because they need more adjustments. One car that did not want to see it is Dave Blaney because he actually put a little cushion on that fifth-place car.
Well, he's going to get to ride around here and not use up his tires quite as much, so that's just making this strategy work a little bit better. And one thing about it, Larry, you can't come in now. You made your bed.
You're committed.
You're committed now, bud.
But we still have about 60 laps to go. I'll be willing to bet we'll have guys back in the pack that'll make a stop.
That caution's good news for Paul Menard. He was the first car one lap down, so he'll get the free pass. And when we restart, we'll have 20 cars on the lead lap. Only four cars in the garage. Kenny Wallace, Casey Kane, David Gilliland, and Jeff Burton is only DNF in 26 Richmond races.
Looks like the top six cars stayed out, but here comes everybody, Steve, from about Tony Stewart on back.
Yeah, a little miscommunication here in the 17 pits, Larry Mack. Matt Kenseth was already committed to pit road, and he said nobody else is pitting in front. Robbie Rogers had stay out, but he was already committed. Matt.
There was so many cars staying out, the 20 team opted to come in and get tires for Tony Stewart, trying to score their fourth win here at Richmond and their first of 2007.
Setting up for a roughly 60-lap run to the checkered flag here in Richmond, you're watching NASCAR on Fox. America's oldest NASCAR super speedway. Did you see those wing cars from 1970 and 1971, those Charger Daytonas and Plymouth Superbirds? Wing stock cars will be back at Darlington this Saturday night.
Yeah, those were big, tall wings back
yes,
in those
they were.
Days.
Here's our Napa race summary. After 340 laps, 12 different leaders. Jeff Gordon has led the most laps, 114. Kevin Harvick's led 105. The 12 or 13 laps we ran under yellow last night did not count. Since we never went green, they declared a complete restart, so all these 340 laps were run today.
Mike, let's set the stage here. We have 59 laps to go. We'll have 58 to go when they get to green. We have 20 cars on the lead lap. We had a split decision there. With 20 laps since the last pit stop, the top 10 cars stayed out. The other 10 cars made a pit stop. Tony Stewart back there in 11th, being the first car that has four fresh tires.
So the Jim Stewart 400, honoring a contest winner, as presented by Crown Royal, has now just 58 laps to go. When they get to the line, Jimmie Johnson takes the green flag. We're racing.
I think the front four or five up there, they'll probably settle down here, and that's kind of how they're going to be. But I think those guys that got four tires, Tony Stewart and a couple of them, they got their work cut out for them to get back up there to the front, I think.
Well, Tony Stewart restarted in 10th, but with all those lap down cars, it was like restarting back in 20th.
And it's just not that easy to pass. I mean, we saw him get held up by the 41 and the 1 there a bit ago. Tires are good, and they help a lot, but I don't know if they help you get through this traffic or not.
Three wide, turn two, and Hamlin has to back out of it.
Yeah.
He almost got the nose just squeezed right off his car.
Boy, he definitely gave Dave Blaney a break right there.
I was going to say, he really cut Blaney some slack on that one.
He was there, but there was no where to go.
And once again, the 41 car was kind of trying to get out of the way. You see the red car on the inside, black car on the middle. There's Blaney on the outside, and the 41's not doing anything wrong. He is a lap down, but hey, where's he going to go? And
he's Blaney, the first car lap down.
Right, and Blaney had nowhere to go. He was right out by the wall. So
that's why they call it racing.
But I mean, Reed Sorensen is doing everything he can to stay the first car lap down to get that free pass should we get a caution.
And he's doing a good job. I mean, he's not getting in these guys' way as Ford's just running all over the racetrack.
But Sorensen has to watch out for Tony Raines, who was right behind Hamlin, because that's the battle to be the first car one lap down, the 41 of 96. Oh, meanwhile, back at the lead.
It is heating up at the Hendrick shop up here.
It is?
Oh, yeah.
But you know what? I get emails every week asking us, why don't we talk about the Hendrick cars? We know there's other cars out there. This is the reason we talk about them, is because they led over 200 laps of this race today, and they've won 6 of the 9 races. What are we supposed to talk about?
How about 3 wide going into turn 3, Larry?
All right, we'll talk about that.
It's kind of like a bad dance going on back here.
Kurt Busch made a bold move, and he ended up getting around both Casey Mears and Tony Raines.
They're swapping everything but partners.
Hamlin passes Blaney for fourth place.
Tell you what, just to have those two right side tires, Dave Blaney in that 22 car doing an awfully good job trying to get Toyota's first top 5 finish in Nextel Cup. There you see they only have one top 10, Brian Vickers back at Fontana.
I think he'll be all right, Larry, for a while. I just don't know if that'll hold up, though, with these guys on 4.
I think we may end up getting a caution unless Kenny Wallace in the 78 car can get going.
He has stalled in the back straightaway.
Yep, he has.
Trying to get to the wrecker opening caution waves.
No, that's good news for Blaney. The more times you ride around here slow, the better off you are.
No, NASCAR, I tried.
Wallace tried to get back to the garage in his Furniture Row Racing Chevy, but could not. So the caution waves for the 11th time today.
Just to update you on Tony Stewart, we basically ran almost 10 laps. He only gained one position back there with those 4 fresh tires.
Yeah, as long as these cars are bunched up the way they are, the tires, you're going to use your tires up just trying to get by some of these cars back in the back here.
Guess what? Reed Sorensen, the 41, finally got the free pass. He's back on the lead lap.
And that's a great job for that young man. I mean, I know people, we've complained about him. Some of them have been in the way, but he's doing what he had to do.
So we'll have 21 cars on the lead lap for the restart.
Racing is not always just about one guy. It's about everybody.
No, and that free pass really comes into play. J.J. Yaley got it a couple of cautions ago, and now he's up to 12th place. So it really does pay off, fighting to stay in position to get the pass. He would have got it 2 cautions earlier, except he was the caution, so that made him ineligible that time. But a good run for Yaley. All the Gibbs cars in the top dozen.
There you see Clint Bowyer, those 7. He's up in the top 10. Just been quietly hanging out just outside. They stayed out the last time. Gil Martin, the crew chief, he's up there in the 8th position.
So the DirecTV car makes it into the top 10. Not been a great day for Richard Childress. A pit road crash for Kevin Harvick and a DNF for Jeff Burton. So leaving Bowyer to carry the flag.
Oh, it was going to be a great day for the 29 car until, of course, what happened in the pits, and now.
Time for our Nextel call of the race. Nextel helps NASCAR fans get things done. Who do we think has made the call of the race?
Well, the obvious choice at this point would be Blaney with his 2 tires. We'll have to see if that plays out or not.
I like that one as well, but I think I'm going to go with a group that early in the race decided to bite the bullet on pit road and unhook a rear sway bar. Greg Zipidelli in that 20 car. They have 4 fresh tires back there. He's going to have to go, but that was quite a move there, getting it done just like sprint.
I'm going to go with that number 2 team.
Yeah.
Kurt Busch, Roger Penske has won here with Rusty Wallace. He's run here with Ryan Newman. And Bush's day started out not too well, got deep in a hole, got the side of the car all scun up. But he fought his way back up and into contention, led 27 laps, and who knows, this is far from over.
So he got the side of the car scun up?
That was one of your words. I borrowed that. I hope you don't mind.
No, it's okay.
Krista.
You guys talked about those right side tires for Dave Blaney. He took those back on lap 315. Well, Ryan Newman also took right sides only on lap 338. You know, I talked with Ryan earlier this week, and he said, well, we haven't had good track position or good pits all year, but they're having a great run today. Starting 30th, been running all day long in the top 10.
And I know a car that gave up a lot of track position that time as well. He was one of the cars that elected to stay out the last time. Evidently, Kevin Mannion felt like Mark Truex Jr. just was not going anywhere, and they elected to come pit road along with Bobby Labonte, David Strimi, J.J. Yaley, Paul Menard, and Reed Sorensen.
All right, we're on one to go. So briefly to Matt.
And Chad Knauss feels like there's going to be more cautions, Mike, as well as Jeff Gordon says another heat cycle on the tires should help tighten this car up, which has been almost like dirt track in about the last 150 laps of the race.
This could be the final run. It'll come with 47 laps to go. The Chevrolets of Jimmie Johnson, Kyle Busch, Jeff Gordon, and Denny Hamlin. Then Dave Blaney's Toyota, Kurt Busch's Dodge, Clint Bowyer's Chevy, Ryan Newman's Dodge, Tony Stewart's Chevy, and Matt Kenseth's Ford, the top 10.
And Jeff Gordon is so smooth behind the wheel. His car cannot be handling well, and you really can't tell it.
Green flag.
Boy, Kyle Busch, that five, he just about had the rear of his teammate Jimmie Johnson's car jacked up in the air. Makes a move to the high side, gets a pretty good run.
That's what he did the last restart, Larry. The 48 doesn't get off to the greatest of restarts. Here comes the five. Pinning down here, he might be able to get around him.
The three lead Hendrick cars with Casey Mears right with them, a lap down.
To run that bottom line like Jimmy likes to run, you need to be able to let the car go all the way out to the wall on corner exit, and he can't do that with the five out there.
He's keeping him pinned down on the exit of both corners. They'll be neck and neck halfway down the back straightaway.
But while they're racing side by side, Larry, they're pulling away.
And that's hard to believe, that it just doesn't bring the rest of the pack right. Trouble turn three.
Biffle. Greg Biffle. Caution will wave. Now, NASCAR will have to go back to the last scoring loop the minute the caution was displayed to see exactly who was leading, either Kyle Busch in the 5 or Jimmie Johnson in the 48.
They didn't come down on him, Joel.
No, he went way up the racetrack.
Well, let's see who he was that Greg Biffle is talking about. Watch his number 16, and it's Jeff Green in the 66.
Same thing happened with the 66 and the 8 a little bit ago. This time he got the Biff.
And look at Kevin Harvick in the 29, just
man,
barely gets
thread
through
the
there.
Needle, buddy, right through there.
The free pass car will be Casey Mears.
Looks like that 66 goes in there and locks up the front tires, and if there's anybody on the outside of him, he gets right into him.
If you ever drove your street car on ice and went into the corner, hit the brake, and it locked up, the car goes straight. It doesn't turn. Same story here.
Down the middle of the track.
We rode with Carl Edwards. He did a pretty good job, like Kevin Harvick as well.
Yeah, brother, do you need anything?
It's Bob Osborne.
You saw that onboard view. We're going to make Carl Edwards our All-State Good Hands driver today on behalf of Carl. Watch his number 99 squirt through here. Allstate will donate $1,000 to the Urban Youth Racing School. Allstate, official insurance sponsor of NASCAR. Are you in good hands?
I think the 29 and the 99 both did an outstanding job right there.
Casey Mears will pit. It's a free stop for him since he's the free pass car. There are some other takers on pit road like Allmendinger and Jeff Green.
I think NASCAR has determined that the 5 was in front of the 48. Right now they're still sorting between Dave Blaney in the 22 and Kurt Busch in the 2, who's in fifth position. They've been sorting through that for about a lap or two now.
Steve?
And Mike, you've documented how Kurt Busch and that 2 team, how they fought back from losing a lap early. The problem he has right now with about 40 laps to go, he says, I just don't have much front grip right now.
And Larry, this race is doing exactly what the trends of this race always is. Starts off with a lot of cautions and ends up with a lot of cautions. But that middle section, we can run 100 or two laps under green.
We ran 127 laps under green, and that is the longest stretch of consecutive green flag laps we've had all season.
And that's, again, that's a pattern we have here. It doesn't matter if it's in the spring or in the fall.
That just tells you these guys are up on the wheel when it starts, and then they get real anxious when it gets close to the end.
So we'll have 40 laps to go when they cross the line and take the one-to-go sign. And the number of lead lap cars now up to 22. Coming up on Fox Saturday night, Darlington, South Carolina, the historic speedway that's played host to NASCAR since 1949. And then we go to Charlotte for the All-Star race and the Coke 600, 2 weeks in a row, Saturday nights at Charlotte. And then Dover International Speedway in Delaware, Sunday, June 3rd.
The All-Star race will be under the lights on Saturday night, actually on speed.
These cars at Dover, that's going to be interesting.
Wow. These cars at Darlington Saturday night.
That's even more interesting.
I think that's definitely the race they've all had circled with this car tomorrow.
Just talking to Jeff Gordon, he did the tire test. He said, DW, it's got your hands full.
They've sorted out the scoring. Kyle Busch the leader, Jimmie Johnson, Jeff Gordon, Denny Hamlin fourth, and Dave Blaney fifth. Kyle Busch has run four Nextel Cup races here. He's finished fourth, fourth, fifth, and second. He's your leader with 39 to go.
Darrell, it doesn't matter whether he's leading or running second. He seems to get a great restart with that five car.
Yeah, he really does. I noticed when Jimmy was leading both times on a restart, he just about got it by him. He did this last time and sort of pulled out there on that restart too. That just tells you he is ready. He's sitting on ready.
Kyle, of course, won the very first car tomorrow race back at Bristol a couple of months ago, but he's got his hands full right now. Jimmie Johnson in that 48 car is pretty much running in his tire track.
Car in the wall, turn one, Stremme, caution.
Yeah, Stremme's been struggling with that car ever since he and the 9 got together there a little earlier on the front straightaway. Getting a lot of cars back on the lead lap.
And we took that restart from the Army car of Mark Martin. Now he will rejoin the cars on the lead lap. And the hits just keep on coming. Caution number 13.
Stock Cup Racing on Fox is sponsored by Mitchum, with you all the way. By Napa Auto Parts. Napa, get the good stuff. By Diet Pepsi, more cola taste. And by Nextel, only from Sprint, helping NASCAR Nextel Cup fans get more done.
With Mark Martin, now 22 cars on the lead lap. It'll be 33 to go when they get the green flag this time by. Three Hendrick Chevys, one Joe Gibbs Chevy. A Bill Davis Toyota in fifth, that's Blaney. Penske Dodges in sixth and eighth. A Childress Chevy in seventh, a Joe Gibbs Chevy in ninth. And a Roush Fenway Ford in 10th. Here we go with Kyle Busch on point. Green flag.
And he's shot out of a cannon once again, man. He takes off.
He is absolutely on keel when they drop that green flag. You know, we've talked about guys that like these caution flags. Guy that hates it is Tony Stewart back there in that 20 car with those four fresh tires. Can't make up any ground.
No, he's on the outside of about a row of eight lapped cars on the inside. Nowhere to go, even if he could get there. Right behind Newman.
And all these caution flags are helping the heck out of Dave Blaney, because he's not riding around there hurting his tires, that's for sure.
Let's go to the second place pit. Here's Matt.
About 30 laps to go. Chad Knauss is watching his car on exit. Chad, that caution hurt or helped your car the way it was handling before?
All these cautions are definitely hurting us. You know, we were really good there. That caution hadn't come out, I don't believe the 5 car would have been ahead of us. But, you know, it's great to see the Hendrick Motorsports car boarded up for us. 1, 2, 3. Wish Mr. Hendrick could be here with us today, but he's doing the Ricky Hendrick Memorial Charity Ride, so that's a really cool thing. You know, I'm glad he's there, and I hope he's catching the end of the race.
Thanks, Chad. Mike?
Chad Knauss, team player.
8 car just went way up the hill down at 1 and 2, Mike. Got way up in the loose stuff. Didn't hit anything, but cost him a lot of spots. The thing that they got to do with a 5 car, they got to be sure that he doesn't do like he did at Bristol. Remember when they had to tell him to slow down? He was overdriving the corners. He needs to slow down. He's overdriving these corners.
boy, Dave Blaney in that 22 car just drove it down into three, and he's going to lose all kind of positions.
Oh, Ward.
Ward. Wow, Ricky Rudd. Sideways. Tony Stewart gets damaged. Caution is out.
Ward Burton in the four was trying to stay the first car one lap down, and he got hard into Ricky Rudd.
Yeah, he just gassed it up and not at a good time.
And it all started getting into turn three when Blaney got in there, washed up the racetrack with the front tires just sliding and smoking.
These cars just don't like to be close to each other.
And Martin Truex had a great run going.
He stalled
top
out.
Top 10, and he stopped.
Ricky Rudd's got serious damage with fluids running out.
Yep. Couple of Virginia gentlemen pile it up here in turn three. Watch the four of Ward Burton. It all happens surrounding him as he trails Blaney.
Blaney locks the brakes up, getting into three. That slows his momentum down. Here comes Ward, and he's just trying to go three wide, and it's not enough room.
Ooh.
Turns Ricky Rudd. Boy, Blaney was lucky. And Tony gets a little piece of it.
Darrell, I'm not sure I can pin that on Ward. I believe Sterling Marlin might have gotten the back of Burton and turned him around.
Did he bump him?
I think so. Marlin's in the 14.
Oh, yeah, you're right.
He pushed the left rear around on the four car, turned the left front down into Ricky Rudd, the 88.
Did you see that little clip that Blaney got right on the left rear corner of the bumper, man? And there's Tony. He gets a piece of it. Yeah, we'll see here. 14 gets just a little bit into the four, gets him loose, and when he corrects it, goes right into... And then, 88.
And then Marlin almost got turned around by Kurt Busch, and Tony Stewart could not avoid Burton.
And here's Blaney. I see he did spin. Yeah. He's coming down through here. He just got clipped.
And Montoya got turned around, and you see Truex as well. Now they're pushing Truex's car out of the grass. I guess it will, it's trying to refire. But
well, you're in the middle.
Ricky Rudd took a hard shot into
the
wall.
Boy, he did. I mean, he just had no idea that was coming.
Now, here's Truex in the one trying to check up.
A.J. Allmendinger, I saw him with damage on pit road. That's who got in the back, the left rear of Truex Jr. in the one car.
I told you.
The Truex's car was in gear going backwards. All that unburnt fuel piled up, and that's why they couldn't get him restarted. Now they have, as Ricky Rudd, former winner and veteran of this track back to when it was a half mile, walks away.
Won a race here with his eyes taped open.
Yes,
from
1984.
A serious crash, yeah, yep. At Daytona the week before.
Dick Berggren?
Well, Alan Gustafson's car with Kyle Busch at the wheel has gone from 34th starting position all the way to first. But today, your driver has been playing offense until now. Now he has to play defense and with a teammate behind him. How does he do that?
Anytime you got Jimmie Johnson behind him, it's going to be tough. But I'm just real proud of all these guys on this Kellogg's Carquest Chevrolet. They've done a really good job. We struggled yesterday, and nobody got down. Everybody kept their heads up, kept digging. Got this car running well now today. Kyle's done a well of a job. That move on Jimmy, that's all Kyle Busch right there. So we're going to do all we can. It's nice to have teammates behind you and see if we can't get a 1-2-3 for Mr. H.
Why is he so good on restarts today?
A lot of it's Kyle. You know, gearing that Hendrick horsepower doesn't hurt. So total combination. It's a total team effort top to bottom. Kyle's really good here at Richmond. He's always been good here at Richmond. His record shows it. So we'd like to get that thing in victory lane.
Yeah, the pit crew has been sharp today too, Mike Troy.
Yes, they have. As pointed out, Rick Hendrick is not at the racetrack today. He's at Lowe's Motor Speedway, the finishing point where many, many motorcycles participate in the Ricky Hendrick Memorial Charity Ride that started down at Knight's Castle just south of the North Carolina line where the baseball team plays, and rode up to Lowe's Motor Speedway to raise money for charity. Ricky was a motorcycle dealer in the Charlotte area, as well as the youngest NASCAR car owner to win a Busch Series championship, and had quite a driving career as well. What a start to this season for Hendrick Motorsports. A big day for Rick Hendrick's teams.
Got Hendrick Motorsports here, a little domination going on.
The Hendrick team seems to have it figured out here.
I'm going to give it to the whole Hendrick team.
It is staggering, the success of Hendrick Motorsports, whether it's the car of tomorrow, yesterday, today, the race we're watching right now, and with Kyle Busch, Jimmie Johnson, Jeff Gordon, your 1-2-3 drivers here with 24 to go, Jeff Hammond. Let's talk about how Rick Hendrick makes it work. And they, you know, they remind me of the New England Patriots, who won 3 Super Bowls in a 4-year span. The Patriots have been to the playoffs in the NFL 4 straight years. And whether it's playoffs, championships, contending every week, that's what Rick Hendrick and his drivers do.
That's exactly right. And the thing is, right now, we talk so much about Jeff Gordon and Jimmie Johnson and you know, Casey Mears along with Kyle Busch. I mean, they're kind of like the top of the pyramid. There's so many people, and the base of this thing is so wide when you think about the engineering, all the people that help kind of get these cars prepared so that the crew chiefs can go out, take advantage of these drivers' talent, and put these kind of race cars up front.
And it isn't just, hey, he's got a lot of money, let's spend the money, right? He knows where to spend the, or how they're spending it the right way.
It's a people game. We take a look right there. Steve Letourneau, crew chief for Jeff Gordon. We've already mentioned the fact Larry McReynolds and Mike and Daryl talk about the fact that he swept floors. Chad Knaus, he learned under Ray Evernham back when he was kind of like in his heyday. All these guys have come up through the ranks. Alan Gustafson. These guys have just learned from the best, and each time, I guess you might say, a hole is there, a gap is there, you know, he's able to promote from within and keep everything so strong within Hendrick Motorsports because of that.
And you pointed out it's very much a team sport, but now with an individual driver. We saw it earlier in the year with Jimmie Johnson and Jeff Gordon here. So how do you, I know Rick Hendrick's just think of the big picture, but right, how does Kyle and Jimmie and Jeff, how do they think when they think my big picture is me winning the race?
Well, that's where you kind of like get a little bit on the dicey side. And Rick tries not to interfere with that because he wants the guys to settle it on the racetrack. But you've got to realize it's the big picture. It's what everybody's looking for, is making sure you get yourself in position to win a championship along with races.
All right, our picture is the finish to this race. Let's rejoin Daryl, Larry, and Mike.
Daryl, you raced 4-1 for Rick Hendrick. Talk a little about that organization for
us.
Well,
Rick is a visionary in a lot of ways. He was one of the first guys that was able to make multi-car teams work. The reason he can do that is because he has a theory. You get the people first, and then you build around the people. You don't go out and get sponsors and cars and drivers. You get people first, then you build around the people. That's the way he does his dealerships. That's the way he does everything. He is a people person.
And I think when you look over there, you see faces that have been there for years, because Rick takes care of those people once they're there and they become solid with each other. You don't see a big turnover at Hendrick Motorsports.
They've gotten the one to go with 3 of Hendrick's cars in the first 3 positions. Kyle Busch, Jimmie Johnson, and Jeff Gordon, who won the pole.
Rick makes it look so easy that it makes you want to go out and do it yourself. I did it. Ricky Rudd did it. Ray Everham has done it. That's just kind of the way Rick does.
And it's not real easy.
No, it's not real easy. He just makes it look easy.
I recall a time when he made NASCAR very nervous. It was about a year before he started his team and entered the sport. NASCAR wanted to know, who's this Rick Hendrick who's coming around asking all these questions about how things are done and what people are made, are paid, and what equipment is needed? They didn't realize he was doing his homework before he jumped into this sport feet first.
And we're going to get a restart here with 20 to go. We do need to make note, Tony Stewart in the 20 car involved in that wreck back in 6th position. They determined that right front was not rubbing. They left him out. Time to go for it.
20 laps to go. Short track shootout time in Richmond.
Denny Hamlin, he tried to look to the inside of Jeff Gordon in the 24, but the door was shut. We're riding with him here.
Got the lead, though. That 48 car wants back in the lead right here, boys. They got to be really careful, though, not to get into each other.
Plenty of room.
Jimmy runs that bottom so well, and Kyle didn't get quite his restart that time. He got the leather the last couple of times. He'll fight back on the outside, pin Jimmy to the inside. It could be now he's going to make it.
Kyle gets in the corner good, through the middle, just can't get off there, up in that second groove right now.
He says, okay, I tried the outside, it didn't work. Let me look underneath you here and see if I can make something happen.
4 cars have broken free of traffic, Gordon and Hamlin, as well as the 2 leaders. But Kurt Busch and Tony Stewart are still stuck in a group of lapped cars with nowhere to go. Look at that pile.
Yeah, they're in a box right now. They can't go anywhere. Remember, Tony Stewart has much fresher tires. Give a little bump to that 2 car down in 3 and 4, move to the inside. Guys, I'm running out of laps. I got fresh tires. Here I come.
Oh, man, he got underneath Kurt. He got her loose there. About turned her around.
He's got Kurt's teammate, Ryan Newman, right on his bumper.
That old fender all knocked off the right front there. It's got to be hurting his downforce a little bit, but who knows? Sometime your wreck may run better.
That's if these cars had a lot of downforce on the right
That's
front.
Right. Yeah, I did. I didn't have any to start with.
Right. Johnson beginning to distance Kyle Busch by about three car lengths.
I don't believe there's anybody that can step it up that extra little bit right at the end of a race than Jimmie Johnson.
Good. He's starting to overdrive the corner, trying to keep up with you.
There you go.
From him.
That's what they need to tell. They need to be telling that to the five cars. Slow down. You're overdriving the corner.
What you often tell us, Darrell, sometimes you have to drive slow to go fast.
Slow down and go faster. We saw him do this at Bristol.
You can see it. He just drives off in the corner so deep, and he pays the price through the middle and on the exit of the corner of the five car.
14 laps to go.
Jeff Gordon's got his hands full of Denny Hamlin in the 11 car. Pulls up beside him. Gordon gets a good bite off the corner. We'll see what happens down here in 3 and 4. I think you'll see Denny drive it down in there to the bottom.
Krista?
Before that last caution came out, Denny Hamlin got on the radio and said, man, I am better than the 24. That's what you're seeing on the track right now.
And better by just fractions, though, because it's going to be hard to make that pass without getting into Jeff Gordon.
And they've got a little bit of cushion right now because it's quite a ways back to Kurt Busch in the two car, plus there's two lap down cars in between them and Kurt Busch.
Hamlin got a good run this time.
If he can ever get right where he is now and pick the throttle up just a little quicker, right in the middle, right there, maybe. No.
He should be able to complete it, though, I think, going off into turn three.
Got him.
And he will.
Got him. Once you get that car length, once you get alongside the guy, you got eight tires to work with then.
And one thing we...
You'll run the rest up now. Hit your mark.
One thing we've seen here, Darrell, that cross-under move does not seem to work here with these cars.
Yeah.
Once you get past, you're past.
Yeah, you just can't get these things to cut good enough to go back underneath the guy.
Meanwhile, 10 laps to go. Coming this time, Jimmie Johnson has built a three-quarter of a second lead over his teammate Kyle Busch in the five.
Eighth place, two Childress cars. Kevin Harvick trying to fight his way back. Clint Bowyer, the Friday night Busch Series winner, trying to hold him off in the 07.
Kevin's got to be sick with what happened to his race car. Car capable easily of winning this race. Ends up damaged in the pits. Tony Stewart is in big trouble back here too, guys. He's got Ryan Newman beating his back bumper off.
Tony is sixth, having to run defense. Now, Jeff Green is not on the lead lap to 66.
No, he's a lap down.
But this is another good run for those Penske cars. The 12, Ryan Newman, and the 2, Kurt Busch, is up in fifth. Both of them had top 10 runs at Talladega. Penske's starting to get their arms around this thing.
Eight laps to go.
Yeah, I thought Kurt Busch had the car to beat there for most of the early parts of the race. He settled in right where he is now in the top five, but still a great run for he and Ryan both.
Now, Dave Blaney, you see the Cat Camry just ahead of Dale Jr.'s car here. He took two tires, was 13th when he pitted, and now he's 12th. So he's going to end up just about where he would have been if he'd taken four. But he got a look at the lead.
But, you know, he got spun out down here in that melee.
Right.
So he lost some spots there. It's not really been as much performance as it has that little accident he got involved in.
I know we're looking at that battle right there, but I've been watching this battle between Ryan Newman and Tony Stewart, the 20 up here. I mean, both of them are smoking the tires, getting off in the corner.
Well, I'm not sure why Jeff Green is up here messing with these two guys when they're racing for position.
Now, somebody's going to use somebody up here with six to go.
Got
so pick your
everywhere.
Battle. Leaders at the bottom. Newman, a nudge to Stewart. That was more than a nudge.
Yeah, I think it's going to get down to getting ugly right here. And there goes Jeff Green. He gets his dog in this fight. I'm not sure why.
And here comes Harvick.
And now we're going to see a payback.
Yeah, there it goes right there.
Sixth place is at stake here.
And I think we're not finished paying back. No, they got to Tony in time.
But here comes Harvick on the outside. Got four laps to go.
Tony's old piece is all, you know, beating up no right front fender. And he's just doing all he can to salvage what he can.
You know, the way these front and rear bumpers match up, you just can't bump these guys out of the way like you used to could.
No, your front bumper was so much slower.
You saw Tony run into the back of the 12 and it didn't hurt him a bit. He just slid up and went on.
Sent him forward.
Don't jack him up off the ground like the old car did.
Kyle Busch has found his rhythm. He's gone back to the top of the racetrack to try to chase down Jimmie Johnson. He is a tenth of a second quicker than the race leader, but he has only three laps left to get it done.
And he is burning the right rear off of that thing. He comes off the corner every lap with it sideways and smoking.
Well, he's got that little bit of cushion. You see how far it is back to the 11 car, Denny Hamlin, so he can move that car around just a little bit.
And Jimmie Johnson just sitting there watching him in the mirror. I believe he's going to run out of time.
White flag.
One more good one.
You know, in the old style car, Johnson had only one top 10 here in 10 starts. Different story with the Impala.
Great day for his teammate, too. Jeff Gordon has struggled here last four times we've been here.
Jimmie Johnson and the Lowe's Chevrolet come off turn four to their fourth win of the season and 27th career Nextel Cup victory. Newman and Harvick off the corner. Newman holds on for the spot. Sixth place.
Right behind his teammate, Kurt Busch, who finishes fifth in that.
You never cease to amaze me, brother. Beautiful, beautiful job. Guys, great job prepping that car. You guys are awesome. Thank you to everybody at Hendrick Motorsports for everything you guys do. I just can't say it enough. Thank you, everybody.
Jimmie Johnson, a winner at Las Vegas, Atlanta, Martinsville, and now Richmond. Add to that a second at Talladega, a third at California, and a fourth at Phoenix. Solid second in the points. Chevy congratulates Jimmie Johnson, winner of today's race. From Chevy, an American Revolution.
Unofficially, Jimmie Johnson's going to move up to second in points behind his teammate Jeff Gordon.
Boy, he is scorching those hides, baby. I'm telling you, keep melting them down. Do it, dude. Every rear wing is putting some downforce on those rear tires.
Johnson gains two positions in the standings. Denny Hamlin picks up one. And Kyle Busch climbs two spots to sixth. Jimmie Johnson victorious, comes by, left side of the car to the crowd, carrying a Virginia Tech hat, saluting the memories of those who were lost and all of those affected by the tragedy. At Virginia Tech, the alma mater of at least three engineers and crew chiefs that are part of Hendrick Motorsports. After a great battle with Kyle Busch, I guess that's a celebratory salute of Gatorade from his teammate, Steve Burns.
Have a drink, buddy.
Jimmie Johnson climbs out of the race car. Mike Joy, and he was very emotional when he got here. Fist pumping, acknowledging his team. And he gets the obligatory Gatorade bath. Jimmy, now, honestly, this has not been one of your best tracks throughout your career. What does it mean to win here at Richmond?
This means the world to me to win here. We haven't been that strong here, as you know. Reminds me a lot of Indy last year, where we came back and we were able to beat a track that's been tough on us. So I think this car is a new opportunity for myself and for the team to kind of learn the right setup, me to learn the right rhythm at this track. And we did well, I think, or I hope, a 1-2-3 for Hendrick Motorsports. Some awesome racing with my teammate Kyle Busch.
And wearing the Virginia Tech hat, nice tribute by you guys.
I feel honored to win this race here in Virginia. Obviously, what took place, no one can ever describe. It's so sad. I don't even know where to start. I didn't go to school there. A lot of close friends that did. Great people that work at Hendrick Motorsports that have, and certainly want to dedicate this one to them.
Congratulations, Jimmy.
Thank you.
Mike? Woo!
Hendrick Motorsports, 1-2-4 today. Denny Hamlin snuck in there for third with his Gibbs Chevrolet, but Boy, this Hendrick group, they have it together with this Impala.
Yeah, the car tomorrow, the research they've done, the development they've done, they are way ahead of the curve, boys.
The one car that I felt like could run with these guys today, as we always talk, you have to have the whole package, the mistake on pit road with Kevin Harvick getting wrecked, leaving his pit box very well could have cost him their first car tomorrow win.
Still bounced back for a seventh place finish. That's pretty impressive.
Yes, he did, and a lot of changes in the Nextel Cup standings as a result of this race at Richmond. Matt?
And Kyle Busch with the splash and run. You got him with the visor up.
Yeah, I got him with the visor up. If you beat me, then you get it. But if I beat you, then I can take it back. So that was a good run for our Kellogg's Carquest and Paul SS. You know, we just struggling qualifying with these things, but we seem to get it when the race turns around. So, you know, we also want to thank GMAC, Quaker State, Bosch, UGS, and all the people that are behind us.
Did your car fall off on that last restart, or did his car just get better?
I think, well, both. I think mine fell off a little bit and his got better because we kind of gapped out. Normally we can run together, but the restart before, I was a little bit better than he was, and I got a good start, and I got down in one and two and got a good jump on everybody, but you know, that last caution came out again, but you know, I think he would have caught us anyway. He was a little bit better overall than we were, but you know, still a good day for Hendrick Motorsports. 1-2-4, I believe.
And his average finish in the CO2 race is 3.5. Krista?
Denny Hamlin gave it a run. You caught Jeff Gordon. You had two guys in front of you. I know the cautions, yellow exactly wasn't your favorite color today, was it?
No, it definitely wasn't. Not there at the end. But our FedEx Express Chevrolet was really good. And I can't think of a better way to kick off the Wear Your Hard Earned Helmet campaign for everyone at FedEx this year with a special paint scheme on our helmet. It's a great way to start off that campaign and a great way to keep our season going in the right direction. And I'm very happy with our run.
Another top five in the COT. Chris Myers?
Thanks, Krista. With Jeff Hamlin, let's talk about some guys that we thought had a chance to win their first race of the year. This season did not. Dale Earnhardt Jr. wound up 13th, Tony Stewart 8th. Nothing to be embarrassed about,
no.
But these are guys that are used to victory lane.
Well, I think in Tony's case, he got caught up in that last lap, you know, last caution. He came out, did some damage to the car. I'm sure that took him kind of like out of the hunt. But for Dale Earnhardt Jr., I think they kind of like got behind because of that one bad pit stop, and they never were able to make it up, Chris. I think they just lost their momentum and never found it.
Kevin Harvick maybe had the best car. It looked like, of course, he had the lead. Had the problem in the pits. Let's check in with him and Dick Berger. Dick?
Indeed, he had a strong car, surely capable of winning the race, but whatever happened on pit road that led to the accident?
We just didn't communicate well and just wound up getting tore up there.
You say we didn't communicate. Who was supposed to tell you the six was coming?
Well, I really don't know. I mean, you know, maybe I should have saw him and Todd should have saw him, or, you know, it's just one of those things where just everything just happened all at once. So it's unfortunate, but our recent Chevrolet was really, really strong today, and good thing we wrecked. Probably wouldn't have been a very good race.
Now, Todd came by and had conversation with you. Todd Barrier, your crew chief. Have you already decided how you're going to change things so this never happens again?
I hope so. I mean, you know, we don't need to throw away any more good cars like that. We just got to get it straight, and we'll get it straight and be all good from there.
Great run today. Chris?
All right, thanks. And the Daytona 500 winner did rally, as you saw, to finish seventh in the top 10. As we take a look at the unofficial results here, it was 1-2-4 for Hendrick Motorsports. Kurt Busch, Penske Racing, inching their way back up. Clint Bowyer, who won the Busch race Friday night, ninth. And you see Carl Edwards, he started on the front row, 12th.
Yeah, but how about Dave Blaney right there? 11th place finish him. Big boost as far as that team right there concerned, trying to get back in that top 35.
Tony Raines, who flirted with the lead for a while. Jeff Green, who moved up front, was involved in a couple of altercations with other drivers, rounding out the remainder of the field. Casey Kane, the Everham Dodges, started well up front, but went backward.
Yeah, had trouble as far as that's concerned. Did not, you know, have the kind of finish they were looking for. Guys like Jamie Murray, Jeff Burton, I mean, really a dismal day for them.
After the rain postponed Saturday night's race here, nice weather today, so the points after 10 races and the chase for the Nextel Cup. Jeff Gordon had that wide lead entering here, and it's still 200-plus over his teammate Jimmie Johnson. Denny Hamlin hanging in there. Jeff Burton took a hit for finishing last in this race. Jamie McMurray also tumbled a little bit, came in seventh in the standings. But Hendrick Motorsports, they've won all four of the Car of Tomorrow races, and Chevy has won 9 of the 10 races this year.
And Chris, the key thing right now, everybody keeps asking these owners, do they want to switch to the car tomorrow? I dare you ask Rick Hendrick. He's going to tell you, let's switch right now. They keep winning and doing so well with the COT car, I'm sure he's ready to make the switch.
The Car of Tomorrow, it's the year of Hendrick so far. Baseball next weekend, starting on Saturday, 3:30 Eastern, 12:30 Pacific. You'll see some great matchups among those, the Cubs and the Phils. Check out Ryan Howard and his home run swing. also Tigers and Twins. And then after baseball, 7 o'clock Eastern from Darlington, South Carolina, one of the great tracks and one of the great nicknames, the Lady in Black. And Greg Biffle, who needs a win, who needs to get going right, has won the last two races at Darlington on Mother's Day weekend. We hope you celebrate with us. The fans hanging in there, weathering the weather on Saturday night to come out today and enjoy another victory from Jimmie Johnson, once thought of as maybe Jeff Gordon light. I know he didn't like that, but the defending champ might be on his way to a back-to-back Nextel Cup championship. Jeff Gordon, the last to do that. Want to congratulate our Fox Sports audio crew for winning an Emmy and wish Lynn Mignotti, our travel coordinator, a happy birthday. For Jeff Hammond, I'm Chris Myers. Thanks for spending some time with us for NASCAR on Fox. Have a great week. We'll see you next Saturday right here.